Blog Talk Radio.
10 years ago, a crack commando unit was sent to prison by a military court for a crime they didn't commit. These men promptly escaped from maximum security stockade to the Los Angeles underground. Today, still wanted by the government, they survive as soldiers of fortune. If you have a problem, if no one else can help, and if you can find them, maybe you can hire...
Celsius Hockey.
As soon as you're born, they make you feel small by giving you no time instead of it all. Till the pain is so big you feel nothing at all. A working class hero is something to be. Working class hero is something to be. They hurt you at home.
And we're off. It's the hockey show that hates hockey. It's the LCS Hockey Radio Show, brought to you as always by Honest John Churchfield and by the number one non-updated hockey site in all the land, LCSHockey.com. LCS. Lies, conspiracies, subterfuge. Hey. Huh? Subterfuge, Mike Dell. How about that, huh?
How about shenanigans?
All right. We could do that, too. I was trying to get all real conspiracy-themed on that one, though. Yeah. All right. I guess this is about the part of the show where MJ Martin, you can go ahead and fast-forward now and maybe check back after the hockey talk. Tonight on the show, we're going to talk to the Ed. The Ed will be here, and apparently Cousin Brandon will be here tonight, too. And later on, Mike Dell has two conspiracy segments lined up for you.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell him now, or do you want to surprise him later?
Well, the intro music was a hint.
Okay. So it's something about Green Day?
No, that's not Green Day.
That's not Green Day?
That was not Green Day.
Oh.
Yeah.
Huh. I thought that was their song.
No. No, it was someone else's song, and that's what he's talking about.
Oh, all right. Okay, well, then we'll just let you stew on that a little bit then.
Yeah.
All right, you know, and who knows what else we'll get into. Maybe movies, fantasy football, Penguins just scored, something, anything. So let's just get it over with. Joining me, as always, is the editor-in-chief at LCS Hockey, the attack site, and a man that is still stuffed from Thanksgiving dinner. It's the very busy Mike Dell.
Jerry Farish. Matt Cook just scored for the Penguins.
I saw that.
It's always great to talk about current events that are happening right now on a podcast.
Yes. I mean, we are up to the second with your hockey coverage.
Yeah. So if you're listening to this 2 weeks from now, Matt Cook just scored.
Yeah, he just scored. Even if it's, you know, 2 weeks from now, Matt Cook just scored.
Hey, so no monologue?
No.
What happened?
We talked about this earlier. I said, hey, should I do a monologue? And you're like, eh, you don't have to. And I was like, oh, good, more time for me to watch Super Nanny.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
And what did I do? I watched Super Nanny and then Clean House. And
hey, I just heard on the TV, if you go to Style Network, is that what shows Super Nanny?
If you
go to StyleTV.com or whatever and then / Super Nanny, they're having a contest, you can win, Larry, and spend time with Super Nanny.
You know, that's fine and dandy, but I don't have children.
Yeah, but you want a banger, right? Isn't that what?
No, I do not want to bang the Super Nanny. I mean, it seems like a nice enough lady and all, but I don't want to get up in there.
I was misinformed.
Yeah, of course.
Most
people are.
So yeah, the hockey portion of the show. Are you ready? Do you have a bunch of topics lined up, ready to go?
Not really. I was really hoping that Brandon was going to call in right off the get.
But that doesn't
seem like it's going to happen.
Yeah, because the earlier Brandon calls, the less hockey we have to talk.
Yeah. So guys like Joe and MJ Martin, you're really pulling for Cousin Brandon right now because, and as am I, because, I don't want to talk hockey. But how about this, Mike Val? Oh, well, let me play the news real quick. Why don't we play the news on the march?
That'll kill like 15 seconds.
Yeah. All right. We'll do that. Okay, let me find it here. I'll take my time to find it. Shit. I don't know where it's at. Oh, here it is. All right, I found it.
News on the march!
Right off the top, the big hockey news right now, Mike Dale. Matt Cook just scored.
Yeah.
Matt Cook. Any comments on that?
No.
All right. How about, I heard this story the other day. Brendan Wick got hit by a car, and then he still played that night. How about that? Is that a hockey player right there?
Not a baseball player, I can tell you that.
No, definitely not. Not a basketball player.
Yeah, but Brendan Witt was apparently like crossing the street to buy some coffee, and he got hit by an SUV, right? Is that what happened?
Yeah, an SUV. It wasn't like, you know, it wasn't like a motorcycle. It wasn't like a little Ford Taurus. No.
Not one of the smart cars. You
know? No, definitely not one of those. You think you could pick one of those up?
Well, I couldn't.
No, not you, but how about me?
No, I don't think so either.
I bet I could pick it up. Like, not all four tires off the ground, but I bet I could lift the rear end.
Yeah, I'm going to say no on that. Yeah.
We should stage that, maybe tape it.
Well, there's a guy right above my house here, two streets over. He has a little smart car.
You think he would mind if I came over and picked it up?
I don't see how he could resist.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah, we should. Do you know that guy?
No.
What color is the smart car? Because that makes a difference in the weight.
Well, this is the interesting part about this smart car. Is I believe, see, this is where it gets a little open to debate. I think one half of it is white, and the other half is yellow.
Really?
Yeah, I think, like, the right side of it seems to be yellow, and then, or maybe he just got it painted, and I only see one half of it because of the way it's parked, but it has definitely been white and yellow throughout my its existence, I can tell you.
You know what else is white and yellow, Mike Dell?
An egg. Alexander Ovechkin, that's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, he's white and yellow. Hey, we got a call right now. Somebody's got their little hand up. I don't know who it is, though.
Huh.
Yeah.
Like a box of chocolates.
Yeah. I think it's a California area code.
All right, give it a whirl. Wait, what's the area code?
925.
I know who that is.
Okay, and somebody else is here, too.
Is it someone we know?
Yeah.
All right, well, then, 925 caller, hold on the line, please.
Yes, please hold.
All right, hang on the other guy.
Brandon!
Hello? I wondered where Jerry bought his pantyhose.
What is wrong with you?
Jerry, that's horrible! How do you call yourself a man? Holy hell, I need to have these women.
Brandon.
Hello.
What's up, man?
What's happening? This is nice, by the way. Larry's here?
Holy yeah, Larry's here. Hey,
this
it's Cousin Brandon,
show.
Everybody. Yeah, Cousin Brandon.
This isn't the Ed Show tonight.
Yeah. It's the LCS.
What are you talking about? It's not the Ed Show.
No, it's the LCS Hockey Show. Thursday night.
I'm so confused. What are you talking about? Look. You guys both don't drink too much to understand that you're going to have like a night chat. Look, I don't like it. That's all I'm saying. I don't care about it already.
A lot of crazy stuff happened. The Ed, for some reason, wanted to have his show on Tuesday. And then when we did the show, Tuesday night, I was like, no, why did we have to do it Tuesday night? And he didn't know. But he was the one who called me and told me to schedule for Tuesday. So then our show was going to be last night, but then Larry had a power outage at his house. Right, Larry?
Yeah.
Who is this?
Yeah, so then we said, well, we'll do the show Thursday, and that way we could trick you into calling thinking you're talking to the Ed.
Hey!
Mission accomplished, by the way. Well done.
That was bum a check.
No. Well, Brandon, hold on one moment, please, because I think we have another caller on the line. Is he still there, Larry?
Wonderful.
Yeah.
All right, let me just talk to this guy, because I think I know who it is. Let Larry bring on the caller real quick.
All right, caller 925, are you there?
Hello, number 19, or whatever your name is today. And Larry, it is a pleasure to talk to you because I'm not you, and you're not me. And what does LCS mean? Hi, I'm Security Guy Irv.
Yeah, this is Security Guy Irv, everybody. Now, if people have never heard the Ed Show, Irv is one of the Ed's best buddies, right, Irv? You guys are tight.
That is correct.
And you you call his show all the time. And you're my favorite caller to that show. And
Thank you.
Yeah. So Irv said, hey, can I call the show tonight? And I was like, yeah, sure, Irv. It's the hockey show tonight. It's not the Ed Show, but you can call our hockey show. But I didn't tell the Ed, though, Irv. So I wanted you to call and surprise the Ed, you know?
Well, thank you.
But
thank
called
you
a little,
so much.
You called a little early, though. I thought you were going to call, like, in 20 minutes or so.
Well, unfortunately, I can't do it in 20 minutes. Cookie and I, we're going to go pick up tickets to see Larry the Cable Guy this weekend.
Oh, wow. That sounds
my
great.
God. Yeah.
That sounds like some quality entertainment right there. But, yeah, Cookie is your wife, for the people that don't know. And because there's a lot of rumors that, you know, maybe you don't like the ladies, but obviously you do. You're married to a lovely woman named Cookie.
Yes. Thank you, number 19.
Yeah, the Ed likes
Larry the Cable Guy, honestly.
Yeah.
He's really funny. You don't think so?
No. He's hilarious. Yeah, now, Irv, it's nice that you're able to call in, because also on the phone tonight, besides Larry, is our buddy Brandon Damashek, also known as Cousin Brandon. Brandon, say hello to Irv.
Hello?
Hi there, Cousin Brandon.
Yeah, thanks for calling. Okay. I'm doing my best to add for you.
That is pretty good.
That's really funny.
But here's the big conspiracy. Irv, you know I like the conspiracy talk and whatnot, but a lot of people think that you're just a fake person, a fake character, and that you're voiced by either Larry or Cousin Brandon. But now tonight we have all three people right here on the phone together, so hopefully that will dispel all these...
This is like having Superman and Clark Kent in the same room, no?
That's right. And
what does that
Clark
make
Kent.
Me?
Yeah.
That would make you Lois Lane.
That's right.
I'll take Lois Lane.
Wow, Irv, he liked it, yeah.
That's funny.
That's right, Irv, it was funny. Now, Irv, what do you think about all these people who say Irv doesn't exist? He's just a character by Larry or Cousin Brandon.
I don't understand why they don't think I'm a real guy. My name really is Irv.
Yep.
I'm married to Cookie. I like Octomom. I think she's hot. Kind of like how Larry thinks Super Nanny's hot. Yeah.
Yeah, that's
no.
Right.
So let me tell you, Irv. I don't think the problem is that they don't think you're a real guy. I don't think they think that you're a guy. That's the problem. First of all. Secondly, let me tell you something. And this is not, look, I'm going to do a little self-promotion, but so be it. You need to go over, read the Angry Alphabet, and go read letter L. You know why letter L? Larry the Cable Guy. Go read that and go see what a douchebag that guy is. Done and done.
Yeah, Irv, okay. I don't know if you're aware of this, but Brandon has a blog. What is it, Brandon? Cousinbrandon.wordpress.com? Is that right?
That's exactly right.
And over there, he does a thing called the Angry Alphabet, where each letter in the alphabet, he picks something that he hates. And under L is Larry the Cable Guy. So, Irv, why do you like Larry the Cable Guy?
I just think he's kind of funny. He says funny things. He talks to that redneck guy. I think his imitations are funny. I just like Larry the Cable Guy. He's, you know, he says, gear done. You know, that's kind of funny to me.
Yeah, that is hilarious.
I can't do that imitation very well, but I have been working on a Darth Vader, though.
I have been working on
a Darth Vader.
Can I hear it? I want to hear it.
Certainly. Okay, let's see.
Elevation. The Remus, I am your father.
Wow.
I don't know. It might work. I'm not sure.
Not too bad.
Hold on. Before anybody says anything, we got another caller.
Oh, okay.
All right. Ed!
Huh?
What's up, man?
Ed,
hey,
you're...
Listen.
Yeah, what?
Everybody, it's Thursday night, and it's time for show, and...
This is the hockey show, buddy. This is the hockey show. It's not your show. The hockey show. But hey, Ed, let me ask you: Do you recognize this voice? Go ahead, special guest.
Sure. What does the LCS mean? I don't understand. I know what hockey is, but what's the LCS? The Ed? How are you, Ed?
It's your friend, SGI.
That's right.
Jesus Christ, man, what? What the heck is going on with this guy calling your show?
Yeah,
Thursday night.
Oh,
yeah. He must have thought my show was on tonight because he'd be harassing me like some god dang. Hey, listen, man, I got a Peyton Manning today, the variant. He wearing all white.
Cool.
And I got a Jay Cutler wearing all white, too.
That's a pretty good piece. I want that Brett Favre in that purple.
That's the one I got, too. I got the Brett Favre in the white and the purple. It was at the Toys R Us.
Well, cool. I'll trade you for Jonathan Chichu.
Huh?
Yeah, it's Cousin Brandon. Listen, I'll have you know that when your friend Irv called in,
what?
I tried to do a nice impression of you and dismiss him. Done and done.
Ed?
Why would you guys do that?
I think, have we lost the Ed? The Ed?
Yeah, he just dropped off. Yeah, he just dropped off.
Sweet. Maybe he's watching the Super Baby Fight.
Yeah.
No,
that'd
be good.
Yeah, but,
maybe
he's
choking on a Hershey kiss. That's what I'm saying.
You know, next year.
Or an Oreo?
Yeah, an Oreo still. He's still eating the Oreos. Next year, he's going to try and eat 20,000 Hershey kisses, right?
He's a jerk.
That's a lot of Hershey kisses. But Irv, yeah, you and Ed, you collect those McFarland football men. That's what you guys were talking
yeah.
about there.
Yeah, the football guys, the hockey guys, still got 36 Jonathan Chichus. He plays for Minnesota now, right?
No, Ottawa.
Ottawa, something like that, yeah. I know a little bit about hockey, the red line, the blue line. Nothing about the pink, though. That's
yeah.
kind of creepy.
Hey, security guy Irv, I have an idea. I think you should, Christmas morning, bright and early, I think you should show up at the Ed's house with a nice turkey and maybe some presents.
Yeah,
maybe wish
me
a Merry Christmas. Maybe Hello? You come over. You make him. Oh, there he is. Hey, the Ed, I was just telling security
yeah.
guy Irv, he should show up at your door on Christmas morning. What do you think?
Why would he do that?
To wish you a Merry Christmas. Bring you a turkey, some presents. Maybe you guys eat some Oreos. Maybe you talk football for a little while, of course.
Good idea. Great idea.
Yeah, security corps Irv.
Why is he calling your show? Hey, man, do you know Ted Willer?
Irv, do you know a guy named Ted Willer?
Ted Willer. No, I don't. He's an actor, right?
No, you're thinking of Fred Willer.
I don't know.
Oh, Fred Willer.
Know,
no, that's too bad.
Some mother sucker done made up a Ed Times, but called it Ted Times, and he causing havoc. But I'm finding out some information during this Browns and Steelers game. It's going
so
to
he goes by the Ted, is that right?
Yeah.
Hey,
I'm going to have to hit that guy. That's not right, imitating the Ed Times. That's not right at all. He's not a
he
nice
made
guy.
A bootleg version.
That's
I'll
not
be honest,
cool.
I really like the Ted Times.
Hilarious.
Well, it's funny. I'm actually working on the newspaper right now. It's about the Irv, but it's called The Verge. You know?
Ooh.
So,
The Verge?
Why is everybody, you know what? I'm quitting the newspaper business. I'm going to start a new business because everybody try to always be like me. Oh, like I start rhyming. Then this god dang Cousin Brandon start trying to do poems that don't even rhyme. And then,
how dare you?
I get a radio program on Blog Talk, then the LCS boys want to do one. And then,
yeah, I think ours was around for like a year before yours was.
Yeah, Vertical Radio want to get one. And goddamn.
I'll tell you what, you know what else he
had? I'll be Bill Cosby on this goddamn thing. And then don't nobody give me no jewelry.
Look, at you know what else yet? I hate to tell you this. You know what they do now? On July 4th, they have a hot dog eating contest. Other people are eating food competitively now. How about
That's
that?
That's not right.
It's
hey,
not.
No, I knew
hey,
about
hey,
that. I knew
speaking
about
of
that.
Eating food competitively, by the way, last night I watched Man vs. Food, one of my favorite shows.
Fantastic. Which one were
yeah.
you watching?
I think it was a newer one. He was at some place.
77 jujubes in 1 minute.
No, that wasn't it. But he was at some, I think it was a college town or something. And he was trying to eat a 17-inch, 5-pound burrito.
I saw that one.
Yeah, he wasn't going to do it. He says, I can't do it.
Hold
I got a challenge later.
Hold
and then Joey Chestnut.
Hold on. I got another call. Hold on.
All right,
I'll
Ed.
Be right back.
Thanks. Put us on hold, Ed. But then Joey Chestnut comes walking out, you know, the champ, and he eats
That's
that
right.
burrito in 3 minutes and 28 seconds.
That's right. That's exactly right. He
wow.
takes enormous bites. And let me tell you, by the way, the episode that you want to watch, that it, and it's not even like the challenge at the end, go check out the episode in Little Rock, Arkansas. I don't know if you saw this one. He goes to this barbecue where it's put on every year by this guy. He's essentially just this philanthropist, and he's throwing it for, like, local firemen and police officers. Every single person, now granted, I thought every table got this. Every person gets a tray.
Ed, wait.
Please, I'm talking. Yeah. Every person gets a tray with it's what is it? It's an 8-inch turkey leg, 6 sausages, a big old pound of pulled pork, 3 gigantic beef ribs. They get
my goodness.
What am I forgetting on this? No.
They get their own roasted chicken.
Oh, that's right. They get a 4-pound roasted chicken. So you saw this. It's incredible. Every person gets this.
But you know what the best part is? It's like, on top of that, you get like the little snack-sized bag of chips, too.
That's the best. Right. You get side orders.
Wasn't enough.
You get sides. You kidding me? What about the $4.99
in Africa? You get all that for $4.99?
No, you get it for free. The guy does it for free. He's got this 25,000 square foot farmhouse that he uses, like with like I think it's 11 ovens in it, and all he does is roast
meat.
You
said the Dave got this?
Yes, the Dave has it. You know what you need to do? Go to Los Angeles immediately. Tell him to feed you right now.
Indiana beat Pittsburgh the other night in basketball.
I know. Pittsburgh's been disappointing.
I wonder who the Dave. The Dave probably was like, "Oh yeah, I was for IU, and all day I was for Pittsburgh." Oh,
you know what he was doing? He was trying to have it both ways. This is what he was doing.
Yeah, they said he goes both ways. That's what I heard. Hey, that's like Eddie Murray and Mickey Mantle. It's like switch hitting. Yeah, that's what Dave is doing. That's Security Geyer. He
Well, Geyer.
He was a hot dog sucking contest.
Irv, I wouldn't take that if I were you.
That's not a nice thing to say to you, Ed. I thought we were friends. Why can't we be friends? Why can't we all just get along? We do get along. You just, okay, he just stuck on the longer one. Cookie might have something to say about that.
Yeah.
He might ask about your helmet size. Listen, I'm going to punch Cookie in the mouth next time I see her. You're going to see how that cookie crumbles. Watch how that cookie crumbles.
I don't know. Hey, Viet, let me ask you something. Huh. Did you happen to see? I've not watched this show because I mean I'm like I refuse. There's some show called like Jersey Shore, I think that might be on MTV now. Apparently, they ran part of the show. Some Jersey douchebag punches this girl right in the face. Right in the face, girl. In the face.
Well, she
if you've seen this.
What'd she do? What'd she do to deserve the
punch? You know what she did? She showed up.
That's what happened a lot of times. Hey, man. What you call it? Tiger Woods cheated on his wife.
Yeah, Tiger Woods cheated on his wife. That's right, Dion.
I mean, you know what? Listen, here's the rule in America for you kids that don't know. For every $100,000 you make, you get an extra woman. So, if you make $300,000 a year, you get 3 women. Besides your wife.
Bill Gates must have a lot of women then.
Yeah, he got a whole bunch. Him and James Worthy.
I'll tell you what, by the way, here's something else you might not know. Athletes cheat on their wives. I don't know if you knew that.
Wow. I mean, listen, that's in their contract situation.
Of course it is.
Listen, because when you go to these places, there's always a groupie there. Then, okay, listen, I know, Cousin Brandon, your trash can where you live, a lot of people don't knock on your trash can just trying to throw some, women body pieces at you. But, and if they did, it might be once in a month, and you might be able to say no. But guys like Tiger Woods, I mean, he got to say no 200 to 300 times a day. Now, if he says no 299 out of 300, he said no 99.9% of the time.
But here's the thing, it's like, look, the problem is this. It's not that, and we discussed this a week or so ago. It's not the fact, the fact that he's cheating on his wife is not what's the surprise. It's the fact that he got caught doing it. It's Tiger Woods. It's the most calculated athlete in all the land. It's like, are you kidding me? How did you blow this? Like, you're an idiot. I mean, that's the thing. It's like, am I supposed to be surprised that he cheated?
Not at all. Let me tell you something. Hold on, I got another call. Hold on.
Yeah,
I'm
very busy.
I hate taking up
the
time.
Fat Boys
really
break
did.
Up now. This I just don't get it. Tiger Woods cheating on his wife. Dogs and cats living together. He can't say no. He's too busy saying yeah.
Irv, you would never cheat on Cookie, would you, Irv?
She would beat me up. She's much taller than me. She's like 6'3".
And
wow,
please ask her to stop calling me, please. Seriously, this is ridiculous. I'm trying to live a life. I'm trying to do work, and then saying that was a hey, Brandon. You know, it's enough. Irv,
please. But Cookie's 6'3".
Oh, she's with heels on. She's 6'3". Without heels, she's 6 feet.
Wow.
She's pretty tall.
Yeah, 6 feet. Jesus Christ.
Oh my God. See that again. Well, hey, listen, fellas, I actually have to run. I just wanted to call in to say hello this evening.
That's why you got to run.
Well, that's exactly right.
Yeah,
listen.
One time when me and Momoshek, we was at a ball game together, and we was talking about this situation, about how many overweight people in the Davishek family.
Is that right?
Yeah. They said, you got a drinking problem.
Well, first of all, that's true. Second of all, clearly you've not looked at pictures of me because I am certainly not overweight, certain. In fact, I think I'm feeding the tapeworm inside of me with gin and tonic.
How much do you weigh?
I weigh 13 pounds.
For 2'1", that ain't very big.
But, don't you remember Cousin Brandon ordered a small pink Ed T-shirt back in the day?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh, and you know what, by the way? This is the honest to God truth. I'm wearing that T-shirt right now.
Wow, how about that?
Wow.
I'm wearing my Ed shirt.
Do not wear that to bed, because I'm not sleeping with you. Uh-uh. Take it off before you go to sleep.
Listen, you always talk about me, and you're talking about sleeping with Larry. What are you doing?
That's this fag. Got my shirt on.
All right, Brandon. We appreciate you calling, and don't forget to go to the blog.
He got a goddamn Happy Meal with the girl prize in it. No, you got to get a Happy Meal and say, I want the boy prize.
Look. Bottom line, this booze that I'm working on is not going to drink itself, so therefore I have to go. All right. Fellas, please, you all have a nice evening. I will talk to you soon. And by the way, please, Mike Dell, do not – hey, no, look, Mike Dell, and I know you know this, do not forget to go – there's a nice little shout-out to you over on the blog. So,
yeah, that's right. I saw that. And did you get that email I sent you about the White Stripes opening bands?
By the way, I'm sorry. I meant to respond to you about that. You know who it was? It was the Dobsons. That's exactly right.
That's what I figured,
Exactly right. Okay. But the thing is, I think Brendan Benson might – are you sure he wasn't touring with them as well?
Yeah, he was. He was there that night.
That's right. Yeah, I think he was.
Hey, listen. Hush for a minute. Listen. I just drove by this strip club called Little Darlings, and the sign says hundreds of beautiful girls and three ugly ones.
Well, I don't believe that for a second.
It's true. It's really true.
There are
three ugly ones in it.
Oh, wow.
You know what? I say you make the Ed go take a picture with his phone and send it to you.
Yeah, I would
like to see this.
Hey Brandon, right. Before you go, don't forget the big music review at some point next month or this end of this month, whenever you do.
Let's do that. In fact, I'm working on my end of the year CDs right now. Let's do that sometime.
I've seen his group too the other day. Some kid named Bono.
Yeah.
I sat and talked to him about 10 minutes.
Okay, I don't believe that. I don't
care for Boner either, so it's fine. Yeah. Okay, so
all right, Brandon.
Have a nice evening. I'll talk to you soon.
There he goes, Cousin Brandon.
Well, fellas, I've got to go, too, because I'm going to be in line for Larry the Cable Guy in a couple of minutes. So thank you for having me on the show. The Ed, I will talk to you soon. Number 19, you're the greatest. And Uncle Larry, thank you so much.
Thank you, Irv. We appreciate it.
All right, Irv.
I talked to Larry the Cable Guy one time.
Wow. All right,
on the Adam Show. On the Adam Show.
And what do you think of Larry the Cable Guy, the Ed?
I thought he was a cable man because I had a problem with my cable.
Yeah.
And come to find out, he's a comedian.
Yeah, a lot of people can't tell he's a comedian right away, so it takes some time. But Larry, how about that? We had you on the line, we had Security Guy Irv, and we had Cousin Brandon all together. So.
Yeah, the conspiracy is now dead.
Yeah.
Why? What happened?
Well, everybody thinks that either I or Cousin Brandon is Security Guy Irv.
I thought they thought you was me.
No?
No. I don't think anyone really thought that.
No, nobody can pull the Ed off except for the Ed.
Yeah.
I look like Mickey Rourke's friend.
I thought you looked like Matt Damon.
You look like
Mickey Rourke's friend, Matt Damon.
What does that even mean? Mickey Rourke's friend is Matt. I don't know.
It's the Ed, Mike, though.
Oh, I'm sorry. So the Ed, what's going on? Well, what's going down tonight? Big plans?
I'm just driving around in my car. You can drive your car. Turn on the radio.
Because usually we have your show Thursday night, but you told me you couldn't do it. That you couldn't do it Thursday, so we had to reschedule it for Tuesday. And now here it is Thursday night, and you're calling our show just like normal. So what gives? Why couldn't you do your show tonight?
I'm busy.
Doing what?
I'm driving
your
car.
Around. But you do that all the time during your show.
I'm a pizza delivery man.
No, you're not.
I could be. I do DiGiorno. It's delivery.
Well, but that's not delivery yet. That's the pizza you buy at the store and you bring it home and you cook it.
No, we got a DiGiorno restaurant here, like how Pizza Hut is.
Oh, well.
Yeah, they just get them frozen pizzas and put them in.
I want to hear more about the strip club with the three ugly girls.
It's called Little Darlings.
Little Darlings.
Totally nude. And I thought it said, I didn't know that nude was N-U-D-E. I thought it was a comedy club called Totally Nutty.
That's a gay bar.
I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know about it.
I thought you were supposed to be in school studying human language and spelling. You still don't know nude?
I'm doing good.
Yeah, how is the schooling going? We haven't talked about that in a while. How's it working out for you?
You know what? I've missed quite a few classes. I've got catching up to do.
I can tell,
yeah. Yeah, but sometimes if you go to school and then you drive around, you won't go. Hey, I got to call you right back.
All right, Ed.
All right, bye-bye.
There he goes. Remember that, Larry. Sometimes if you're going to school and you drive around, you won't go.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, so I think we don't have to talk hockey now.
Good, 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 good. But I think we do need to talk about Security Guy Irv and Larry the Cable Guy, honestly. I mean, what is up with that?
Well, you know, Irv's an interesting fella. And
Who goes and waits in line for tickets for Larry the Cable Guy?
Hey, the heart wants what the heart wants, you know?
I suppose. Yeah. You want Tina Fey, he wants Larry the Cable Guy. The world is a mysterious place, Mike Dell.
Yeah, it certainly is. Now, hey, Larry, why don't we talk some fantasy football right here?
And okay.
We're waiting for the edge. Because you're very proud of yourself. Why don't you tell the people what you got cooking?
I got five fantasy football teams this year. You know, I got into five leagues, and five playoff runs I'm starting right now. All five teams made the playoffs, so I'm excited about that. I'm hoping to pull out at least one championship somewhere. You had two teams this year, and how many made the playoffs?
I finished first in one league, and I tied for sixth in the other, and then I lost out on the overall points.
Ooh, that's a real kick in the balls.
To our buddy Matthew Sikorski. But the other big news from that league is that our pal Jim Arvino, who I forgot to tell that there wasn't a show last night, so Jim, if you're listening, sorry about that, buddy. I forgot. But he was 5-0 in our league. Remember, he was all fat and sassy talking about
it. Oh, yeah, he was bragging about it. This is Chim's year. Chim's undefeated.
Yeah, he's talking like he's the best ever. And he went, 1-7 down the stretch or something?
Oh,
so
that's
hurt. He finished 6-7, and he missed the playoffs.
And, you know,
I would have missed the playoffs.
I didn't even realize that until you told me earlier today.
Yeah.
Because
to
Jim's not a real fantasy football force to reckon with.
No, never.
Nah. Neither's Cham, but...
Yeah, this is only the second time I missed the playoffs, though, in all the years.
Yeah, but still, you never won anything.
It was a rough year, because my theory, of course, is always you screw the running backs and you draft top wide receivers early.
Right.
And because they never, the big reason why is they never get hurt. Running backs always get hurt, but stud wide receivers rarely, if ever, get hurt. And then this year I drafted Andre Johnson and Calvin Johnson in the first rounds, and they both were hurt. Sure.
Yeah. But didn't Andre Johnson, didn't he get hurt last year too?
No. But I also made the mistake of drafting my buddy T.O. because I wanted to make it fun.
Uh-huh.
So I thought it'd be great. I could make a lot of jokes and stuff. Because I knew T.O. was going to suck this year. But I'm like, who cares? It wasn't fun. Let me tell you, it wasn't fun.
haven't you?
No. Did you get your popcorn ready?
There was no need.
No popcorn?
No, I didn't have to get it ready.
Huh.
So, Larry, 5 leagues, 5 playoff appearances. Now, one of these leagues, run down the leagues. You're in the ESPN league with me and the Ed and guys like that. And then you're in our Yahoo league, our traditional Yahoo league. Then you're in a money league, right, where you play the big bucks. So
yeah.
That's always nice. Then you're in, what are the other two leagues? I don't even know.
I'm in Sean Leahy's league.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm in his league, and he
is
missed
that
the
for
playoffs
money
as well. No. Just for fun. And then, of course, my random Yahoo public league in which I know nobody. They just happened to be drafting when I was sitting around bored one day. Mm. So I'm like, yeah, what the hell? I'll get into that too. So 5 leagues, 5 playoff runs. Here we come.
Well, how many guys do you have playing tonight in the Cleveland-Pittsburgh game, Thursday night football?
None.
You have 5 teams and nobody in that game. That's hard to believe.
Well, no, it's very easy to believe. Very easy. I mean, I do have Ben Roethlisberger on a couple teams, but I'm not using him.
Yeah, you elected to go with Alex Smith.
Yeah, Alex Smith. And, you know, I was listening to Tuesday's podcast of Damashek, and the shoe's all over Alex Smith, it seems like.
Yeah, he loves him. He wants to have his babies.
Yeah. Hey, the Ed's back. Should we bring
him
on?
Yeah, bring on the Ed. Yeah.
All right. Maybe he'll put us on the hold again.
Yeah.
Hold on, Blog Talk slow. Ed!
Yeah.
What's up, man?
To get this guy his pizza.
Oh, all right.
what did he get on it?
Yeah.
He gave me a $2 tip.
But what kind of pizza did he order?
Large.
Well, okay, but no topping? Like, what kind of toppings?
I don't know. I didn't open it up.
Yeah, see, that's what I was going to ask you, Ed. If you really are delivering these pizzas, which I really doubt. I don't think you are. But would you ever just open up the lid there and help yourself to a piece of the pie? Just, you know.
Not, it's my second night working at it.
Second night. And you're once again, you're delivering pizzas for DiGiorno's.
I'm pizza man. Don't give a damn. I'm the pizza man.
Hey, the Ed, what happens if you're delivering a pizza? Hey, well, first of all, do you have any pizzas in your car right now with you that you still have to deliver?
I got one more I got to go deliver over to these other people's house.
Oh, this will be great, maybe.
And listen. See, this is some bull crap, too, because that last pizza I delivered it, I had to write my time down at 6:32, and it said time was supposed to be was 6:02. I'm 30 minutes late.
This one
was supposed to be delivered at 6:18, and it's 6:38, and I have no idea where I'm going.
Huh.
Yeah, that's not good. Hey, just a quick scoring update real quick. The Cleveland Browns are beating the Steelers 12-0 right now. And it could 12 be
13, nothing. Jesus Christ. Mike Thomas,
the extra
new
point.
Tony Dungy.
Points on the way, so it could be 13-0. Ed, now let me ask you this. You've only been working
this
there 2 days. But what if you're delivering a pizza, and you got your pizza, you're walking up the door there, and what if a really foxy lady opens the door, you know? And then she says, oh, I'm sorry.
I might tip her.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Because what if she says, oh, I'm sorry, I don't have money to pay for the pizza, you know?
Yeah, so you got something else that can take care of that, I'm sure.
That's right.
We take, instead of tips, we take your lips.
There you go. Very good, Ed. Sure you're going to have a long career to get the delivery,
this
man.
This person got, hold on, let me read the ticket here. Hold on, I'm trying to drive. They got one extra large. Oh, I like this sausage pepperoni. Yeah.
Why don't you try a little bit?
Yeah, come on, Ed. Open the box and just eat a couple pieces of pepperoni and then put them back. Like,
they're not
going to
know.
Them up a little bit.
They're not going to
know. They won't know. 12 chicken wings and a 2-liter Coca-Cola. I need a drink anyway. I got a cup in my car.
How about 11 chicken wings?
Yeah, really. Are they going to count? I don't think they're going to count.
Never know. Yeah.
I never count my...
No.
No, look, I can just break 2.5.
Yeah, that's right.
Hold on, let me...
Yeah.
Get away to this light.
This will be good.
Open this box, let me get some... I wonder how many slices it got in here.
I'm going to guess 12.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Yeah, there's 12 slices. How do you know?
Just a guess. Now, why don't you pull one of those slices out and just smush the rest of them together?
That's what I was just thinking. Because I don't, shit, I might have to eat it anyway, because I don't know where these people live.
Yeah, that could be a problem, too. Now, yeah, are you driving, I guess you're driving your own car, or do they give you a car to drive?
They give you a car, and then you got to put this sticker on top of your car.
So they give you a car, and then you got to put a sticker on top of the car?
No, my car. I drive my car, and they give me this sticker light. And I put it on my, it stick on the top of the hood.
It says
the hood is in front of me.
The roof is
on fire. We don't need no water. Let that mother sucker burn.
That's right.
Burn, mother sucker.
Well, by the end, are you any closer to the house where the pizza needs to be delivered? Or are you getting close? Do you know where you're at?
They give me a map, but I can't follow it.
Mm. I find
you need a TomTom, Ed.
Yeah.
Huh?
You need a Garmin.
I don't got no GSP.
Well, here's what we'll do. We'll just pitch it to everybody on the message board. We'll all get together, throw $20 in, and we'll get Ed a TomTom for his pizza delivery gig for Christmas.
And by everybody, you mean everyone except me? 'Cause I'm not...
No, you're included in that. Mm-hmm. And Ted Willer.
No, I don't want nothing from that guy.
Come on, Eddie's hilarious.
Hot. Dang.
Yeah.
I ain't got cheese on the roof of my mouth now. you ever get that? You ever get that when it burn like that?
Yeah.
You're just having trouble. You all right, Ed?
Take a drink of Coke, Ed.
No, I got I know. I'd pour a little bit in this cup.
Yeah, crack that 2-liter open.
Because once you open, they're not going to know it's been opened. Don't worry about it.
No.
No, I go over to his water faucet and put some water in it.
Yeah. And see if you can heat the plastic together to get the cap to melt back to that little ring, too.
I can screw it on tight.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Hold on.
Okay. Well, Larry, did you ever deliver any pizzas in your day?
No, I never did.
Yeah.
I delivered 7 of them last night, and I made $24 in tips.
Wow. Pretty good.
That's not real good.
Jesus Christ, this guy's flying next to me.
More than $3 a pizza.
Hold on, man. I'm trying to... Hold on, man.
Yeah.
Can't, man, I don't know where these people... I don't know where these people live, man.
Huh. Well, what should he do, Larry? Let's advise the...
I might have to go back to the store and tell him I'm lost. Because they're supposed to be delivered at 6:18.
I think the Ed should just quit that job and...
Eat the pizza.
Bam. Goes home with 12 wings and a large pizza and a Coke.
Yeah.
Everybody wins.
Yeah. If I don't find this place by 7 o'clock, I'm going home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like to hear that. Stick it to the man.
Nah, I mean, it's just I'm just lost. I don't know what I'm doing. Sometimes, if you don't know what you're doing, you will get lost.
Yeah. But here's the thing, though, Ed. I hear you when you make these phone calls for the job interviews, and they'll go, "Oh yeah, we're on this street," and you're, "Oh yeah, you're over by that club with the
big street." Those are always on big streets. I know what it is. I don't know where Prairie Grove Street is. Who the hell knows what that is? I don't know. I haven't been there, man. It's probably some kind of goddamn gypsy little mall or something. I don't even know.
Huh.
Hold on. Let me see. Oh, man, I hope I don't wreck. Oh, there's the one I got to... Man, I got to be back because I got another pizza that needs to be delivered at 7:39. Jesus Christ.
They keep you hopping, the Ed. You're very busy.
It's busy.
Now, is there any reason that these pizzas are late because you were at Toys R Us and buying your football figures?
No, I did that yesterday, though.
Okay.
Well, Toys R Us was right by the place I had to go, and I said, "Well, let me go ahead and get this football guy real quick." I was in there like 45 minutes.
Is that it?
Hey, Ed, what if you were to like sneak outside with your cell phone, order a pizza, and have it delivered to your house, then go in and deliver it to your house and just hang out at your house all day?
Yo, It's a good idea.
That's too complicated.
All right. Remember that happened in Do the Right Thing. Remember old...
I don't even remember that.
Yeah, Mookie's girlfriend orders a pizza and he shows up and then he just bangs her.
Oh.
Yeah.
He didn't have no money.
That's right.
He goes, you don't have no money. I got to give you my sausage.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, Matt. Forget this place.
All right, so you're giving up.
Man, I don't know. I've driven around the same neighborhood. Now I'm almost to the freeway, and I know it ain't around here because they said I've driven 47 miles looking for this place, and no, it ain't 47 miles. 27 miles. 27.2 miles. Yeah, I went 27.2 miles, and they said it's only 4 miles away.
Yeah, I think you may have overshot it a little. Hey, yeah, don't they have a phone number you can call and find out where they're at?
Hello?
Ed?
Yeah.
Don't they have a phone number on, like, the little slip there that they order, and you can, like, call them and see where they're at?
Yeah, they got a number on there.
Well, why don't you try calling?
Hold on, I put them on three-way. Hold on.
You don't have to put them on three-way, I mean.
Well,
I
want to hear it.
All right, if you want to, feel free. I don't know.
Hold on, I gotta pull over. I'm still on the street.
All right.
Hold on. I got this new BlackBerry phone.
Wow, you got a BlackBerry?
Yeah, I don't even know how to use it.
How did you afford that?
$6. I got it from the girl. Listen, me and little Bobby knew the girl at Sprint. She hooked us up.
$6 BlackBerry.
Yeah, it was supposed to be $406, and she crossed out the 4 and the 0 and goes, just pay $6.
Well, I have Sprint. Any way you can get me a $6 BlackBerry?
Uh-uh.
Oh, the pen's just scored.
No,
we
can't hook you up. Man, I can't find nowhere to pull over, man. Hold on. Let me ask these people if they order the pizza. Hold on.
All right. We'll hear
conference it. Call.
The Ed's trying to work his magic with his BlackBerry cell phone.
You still there?
Yeah, we're still here, the Ed, huh?
Oh, man, I'm trying to figure out how to call these people up, man. Let me pull in these goddamn... Oh, man, I gotta poop.
I hope you don't lose this job because of that, too. Oh, the Ed had a terrible experience with his last job, valet parking cars. Yeah.
I'm thinking about what you call it? Retiring
Arby?
From work.
Oh, retiring from work. Yeah, that'd be good. I think you're about that age, the Ed, right?
Yeah, I think I'm going to go back to my regular age next year.
Yeah, you're going
to
start?
I'm going to go back. 54. I like being 54. I'm just going to bounce back and forth from 54 to 53 to 55.
All right. Of course, you're actually what? 56 is what your actual age.
Pretty soon we won't remember.
That's right.
Hold on. Let me try to do it. Hold on.
All right. Here we go. This will be interesting.
Okay, conference call. Let's see here. Conference call.
This is riveting radio. Yeah.
5725.
Nope. Yeah, I don't know if you want to say the number out loud. The Ed?
The number you have reached is not in service.
Hello?
If you need assistance, please call directory assistance.
Yeah, we're here, the Ed.
Recording. 702-457. The number you have reached is not in service.
The number's not in service.
Please call directory assistance.
Well, it sounds like you only dialed 6 digits.
702-457.
Usually phone numbers are more numbers than that.
Yeah, like 10 instead of 6.
Yeah. You dialed 702-467 or something. Ed? Did he drop off?
Yeah. Oh, he's back again.
Okay, yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
Where's
hey,
my
yeah.
goddamn pizza?
Hello, you ordered pizza?
Yeah, I ordered a damn pizza. Where the hell you at?
Watch out.
God damn, I called like an hour and a half ago.
Well, I
12
didn't
wings.
Know my address for what I got. I mean, I've been trying.
Where are you at?
Yeah, I'm over by my Lowe's. Now.
Lowe's? You're not
yeah.
even close. What kind of... What kind of retards they got working at this pizza shop? Hello? I want my wings, I want my pizza, I want my goddamn Coke, and I want it now.
What? Did he get scared and leave? Is that him?
Yeah, he hung up again. Oh, that Ed.
Yeah, that's pretty good, Larry.
Hey, I can.
I think you scared him.
Yeah. I might have. All right, here's the Ed again.
Okay.
Hey.
Ed, what's
yeah,
up, man?
I had hung up on a guy who was yelling at me.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Did you guys hear him?
No.
No.
Yeah, he yelled at me. I said, man, listen.
That's all you said?
Did we lose him again?
No, he's here.
So, yeah, you really gave it to the guy? You really put him in his place?
Yeah. I tried. He hung up and got scared.
So now what? Are you going to take the pizza home?
Yeah, I'm going home. Forget this.
All right,
yeah.
That's a wise decision. I think that's
like
the way to go, the Ed.
Yeah.
The guy was like, oh, yeah, bring my pizza. I said, look here, buddy. I don't have to do nothing.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's right, Ed. Yeah, you're not his slave.
I know. That's what I told him. I said, I ain't your slave.
Good. Yeah, good.
And a guy, yeah, I gave him a mouthful.
It's just lucky you didn't show up with that pizza because you would have socked him right in the mouth.
Yeah.
No, he's like, he goes, I know that they hire good people at this place. What's going on tonight? I said, listen,
huh.
Man, you got a messed up address. Post office can't even find you.
That's right.
That's
well, yeah, I'm sorry that the pizza delivery job doesn't look like it's going to work out.
I mean, yeah, it's all right. I got me a large pizza, some wings, and a Coke.
Yeah, you can't go wrong there.
Yeah.
And you made some money in tips. You know, you made a couple bucks in tips. So.
Yeah, I got $17 in tips tonight already.
Wow. Not too
bad. And on top of that, Michael, he's got a nice new sign for his car.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I got that. I got to go take that back to the people. I don't want that. Look what I did. Listen to what I did last night.
What's that?
Is they got an advertisement for $3 off a large pizza.
Okay.
Well, the people did not have a coupon, but I did. So once the guy paid me, I put the coupon in and took the $3 off.
Hey, that's pretty good. Quite the little racket you got there, yeah.
I think that's theft by deception.
Huh.
No, that's called getting in the phone book and cutting out the coupon.
Yeah.
Oh. All right.
That's what that's called. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
My bad.
That's why, and I did it twice tonight, too, because these people don't be tipping. They're talking about, oh, you late. Well, Jesus Christ, man, if you didn't, you know, live in that messed up area, you'd be all right. But they don't do it. They don't live in, like, you know, if they live, if they lived in a place that I knew, it'd be different. But they don't.
Yeah, I don't know what they're thinking, not living in a place you knew.
No. One guy was at the Hampton Inn talking about, oh, bring it to the Hampton Inn. I'm like, how am I going to bring a pizza to a hotel?
Well, you can just, you know, bring the pizza to the hotel. I don't know what's so wrong about that.
I don't know. I didn't take that one.
Yeah. You think it would be pretty easy to find a hotel, though, so maybe that's one you should have taken.
Man, how many rooms in there?
Well, I'm sure they'd leave something at the desk saying, hey, I got a pizza coming or something, you know?
I don't know, man.
Vegas, we ordered pizza at the hotel. You just tell them what room you're in, and they come right to your room and knock on the door like room service.
Too much of a walk, man. Come.
Yeah. The Ed. I think we're losing the Ed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hit a dead spot.
Must have. He must be at that place in his house.
I can hear hissing. Maybe. All right, there you go. Yeah, so hopefully the Ed, you know, didn't run off the road or something.
No, so that would suck.
Yeah, so the Ed was parking cars last week, and now that ended badly. And then you can go back to listen to his show from last week and hear all about it. Or from Tuesday we talked about it, right? I don't know.
Yeah. Wait, he's back again.
Okay. Well, bring him on real quick, and then.
All right. Ed. Hello.
Ed. Hello. Yeah, I think the Ed cell phone is done.
All right.
But yeah, hopefully the Ed will bounce back from this, job because it doesn't sound like he's long for a pizza delivery job. I think it's
no.
Yeah.
Wait, hold on one more time. Let's try him. Ed.
Man, his blueberry phone don't even work right.
Yeah, those blueberry phones are rough. Yeah, so the Ed, Larry and I were just saying, you know, if we feel bad. It's like looks like you're going to be losing your second job in a week or so.
No, I'm quitting. I'm gonna tell him.
Yeah. Well,
Hold on, I'll try to call him.
All right.
What's the phone number to the place?
Yeah, we'll try this real quick. This will be good.
You're going to quit the job on the phone?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this will be good fake radio right here.
Hold on, what's the phone number to?
Yeah.
456.
Yeah, don't say it over the phone.
Hold on.
Well, it's a pizza joint, Mike Dell.
Yeah, well, we don't want to give them any business.
Yeah.
True. Screw those guys, you know what I'm saying?
That is true.
We should have the Ed call our buddy Bernie. He has a pizza joint.
Hello?
Yeah, we're here, the Ed.
Hello?
Oh, no, sir.
Who is that?
What was that, the Ed?
He hung up.
Yeah, whenever he does the three-way thing, he has to hang up to call in again.
Yeah.
But apparently he just called some lady.
Yeah. She sounded a little sexy there.
Oh, yeah. I think so.
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to get it. All right, he's back one more time. Here we go with the Ed. Ed!
No, that was some lady.
Yeah, I know. It wasn't a pizza joint.
No. Can't remember the number.
Yeah.
Thought it was 4569011.
And you were real smooth with that lady, too, by the way. You know, you're quite the ladies' man.
She caught me off guard. I didn't know what to say to her.
I think she wanted you.
I didn't think so. I got her number. I told her, I said, sorry, I got a wrong number.
Yeah, that's very good. Well, yet as much as I'd enjoy, listening to you just call up random people on the phone and then not talking to them, I think we really got to go because we got a lot of stuff we got to talk about in the second hour. So.
I just pulled up to my house. Let me get my pizza. My wing.
All right. Well, enjoy the pizza, Ed. And
I'm gonna call David Stein tonight.
Oh, okay. Yeah, your buddy David Stein. Let me know how that goes, and we'll cut it out and play it on the show some night.
Yeah, maybe he'll order some pizza. I'll tell him I'm a pizza job, see what he say about it.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Is that Sporting News Radio on Sirius Satellite, Ed?
Yeah.
So if anybody's listening to us now and they want to, stay tuned, maybe the Ed will pop up on the David Stein Show tonight.
Come on at 11 o'clock my time.
Wow.
That's a long time from now.
Yeah, 2 a.m.
And I don't know if I'll be up, man.
Yeah.
You had a rough day.
Let me get this pizza out.
All right, I gotta
get my hands full.
All right, Ed. Thanks, buddy. Thanks for calling.
All right, Ed.
There he goes, our pal, the Ed. And don't forget the EdSuperDeluxeWebsite.com, and you can listen to his podcast, The Ed Show. Usually it's Thursday nights at 10, but tonight, we're here instead. But, so how about that, Larry?
That was something.
Yeah.
That was something.
He's having trouble with his blueberry there, but...
Yeah, well, hey. I think technology has passed the Ed long, long ago.
Yeah, I don't think he actually has a BlackBerry. I think it is a Blueberry. I think that's why it was only $6. It was like
yeah. I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah. All right, Larry. Well, what else do we have to talk about tonight before we get into conspiracies? Anything?
No.
No, nothing new, movies, no TV, nothing like that?
No, I haven't seen anything.
All right.
Do you have any interest in watching the BJ Penn? Like, would you know? I'm not saying getting together or nothing, but like, is that like? Do you think that's going to be a good fight?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a great fight.
Who do you think is going to win that?
I would have to go with BJ Penn, but Sanchez ain't no joke, you know. And he just keeps coming. I just think BJ Penn's a different level of fighter, you know. I think.
I think he's just he's too experienced, and I think he's just a better all around fighter than Sanchez. And
Sanchez
he's
is
gonna,
a tough dude. He just keeps going, you know, keeps coming.
Yeah, I think he's going to tap out.
You think?
Yeah.
Huh.
I really do. I really think he's going to tap out.
What else is on that card? Anything?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know, but
we're talking about the UFC Saturday night.
Yeah. Yeah, that BJ Penn, that's going to be good. Let me pull the card up real quick and see if there's any other fights on here.
Yeah, BJ Penn's one of my favorite fighters to watch because he's just very good. You know?
Frank Mir's fighting.
Oh.
He's fighting Czech Congo. Is that how you say it?
Congo, yeah. Czech Congo.
And John Fitch, you know that guy.
Yeah. John Fitch.
Clay Guida's fighting. He's fighting Ken Flo.
Ken Flo and Clay, Clay Guida, the carpenter there. Yeah, that'll be good. Too.
Yeah, that'd be a good. And see if anybody else I know.
Not a bad card.
No, it really isn't.
I just don't know if I feel like driving down to your house.
I hear you. I don't know if I'll be up that late.
But anyway, put your money there. All right, well, you ready to talk some conspiracies, Larry?
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
All right, let's do it.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to ride. I don't want you to write to your congressman because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. I don't know what to do about the depression and the inflation and the Russians and the crime in the streets. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being. God damn it. My life has value.
I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
Now, Larry, since we missed yesterday's show, I promised people two conspiracy segments tonight.
Okay. I'm ready.
We'll get to that in a second. But first, I want to talk about the Jesse Ventura conspiracy show on True TV.
Yeah, well, I wanted to ask you about that. Now, you had an opportunity to see this?
Yeah, they've done it twice. It's on Wednesday nights at 10, which, oddly enough, is the territory that I've already staked out for conspiracy talk.
Yeah, see, there's a conspiracy right there.
Yeah, they're riding my coattails again. But,
yeah.
Yeah, so they've only done two episodes. One was on HARP, which is a secret
beer.
Project up in Alaska, HAARP. And they're shooting high-frequency radio waves into the ionosphere. But they say it's to communicate with underwater submarines, but come on. Well, let's be real. That's not what it is.
Space they're monkey, Mike Dell?
No, not space monkeys. They're trying to control the weather and stuff like that. So, yeah. But we'll talk about HARP maybe some other night. And then the second episode, Jesse Ventura, he got into the 9/11. The 9/11.
Ooh.
And we're going to do that
now
next week on our show. 9/11.
Now, you made mention on the show that you'd really be able to tell if Jesse Ventura knew what he was talking about by the 9/11 show. You'd know like what kind of intelligence he had based on what he had to say. Now, what do you think? What did Jesse have to say about 9/11?
Well, watching the first two episodes of the show, it's clear that Jesse, while his intentions are nice, apparently, he doesn't know anything about conspiracies.
Oh, okay.
Like, he's walking in like a complete naive person. Like, he has no clue. You'd think he would know more about this stuff, but he seems shocked that this stuff's going on. But the funny thing is he has a little group of researchers around him. I don't know any of their names. But the one guy is just a complete idiot. Like, he's just an actor who buys in, who tries to debunk everything. And they have another guy who just buys into everything. And then you have a couple other, you have this one lady who's kind of foxy, and she goes around talking to people. But I don't know. They're kind of silly. I don't know if we need those people. It's an hour-long show, which is surprising. I thought it was only going to be a half hour. But Jesse, he seems willing to dig into this stuff and, like, really delve in. But his knowledge of everything is rudimentary at best. But the impressive thing about the 9/11 show, first, it started, though, they actually went to some of the victims' families, which I thought was a nice little touch there, and to show people that, hey, you know, the people who were killed in 9/11, their families are still, you know, very upset by this, that they're not getting the answers from the government that they want. And people forget that. They think, how can you disrespect the families and the people that died in 9/11 by talking about crazy conspiracies? No, the families are the people that start all this. They're like, you're not getting us the answers we want. You know, we need this stuff explained, and the government refuses to do it. So it was nice that they did that. And then Jesse brought up a lot of good points about the black boxes on the airplanes. The government says they never retrieved them, which is nonsense. You know, there were four planes went down. You got to find the black boxes. They say they never found them, and that's just obviously a lie. And then he brought up, what else? The thermite in the steel, that it can cut through steel. But they talked about a different kind of thermite, really the explosive kind that people always say is nanothermite, and like small minor details about that, but at least it was brought up, and so that was nice. But the thing, and then they tried to do some little hokey thing where they wanted to go to some Air Force hangar and look for steel from 9/11, and that was kind of pointless. But the good thing that they did was they at least alerted people who aren't tuned into 9/11 conspiracy, said, hey, there's a lot of stuff out there that's fishy that we need to talk about. But they barely scratched the surface, you know, in an hour-long thing. The black boxes ate up most of the show, and that was fine. But there's so much stuff to talk about. It really deserves, you know, many, many hours of programming. But the thing that I was concerned about, I thought they were going to hold up a lot of preposterous conspiracy theories. Like holograms and laser beams and kind of stuff that some people actually do talk about a lot and say, well, and then like debunk them and say, well, see, this is just what the conspiracy is. So they didn't do that. So that was you know, a pleasant surprise.
Now, is this a half-hour show or a one-hour show?
No, it's an hour-long show. So, okay. Yeah, it's a lot to go. But so, you know, I was a little worried that they were just going to make conspiracy seem like silly, but because they do that a lot. They call it the straw man. They hold up these straw men, and then they knock them down easy and say, hey, they try and discredit the whole thing. So they didn't do that. So that was, you know, promising. So we'll see. But I think next week they're doing global warming.
Al Gore.
Al Gore's a fraud and a crook. And if anyone wants to, we'll do a show on global warming some night as well. Maybe we'll see what they do about it. But if anyone wants to really find out about global warming and climate change, because they can't call it global warming anymore, they have to call it climate change, because people finally realized, hey, it's kind of cold, you know?
Yeah, it's very cold.
Yeah, so now they call it climate change. But if you want to know the truth about it, everyone get on your Google machines and Google up Club of Rome.
Club of Rome.
That's a think tank connected with the United Nations. And basically, they came up with the idea for global warming and climate change many years ago, and they did it in a way to try and get to globalization, one government, and it's a way to just manipulate the people and milk them for money, and, you know, they create an enemy that everyone could unite against, pollution. But it's just a way of furthering their agenda for one world government and the United Nations and stuff like that. But Club of Rome, go Google that up. And
you know, one enemy I'd like everybody to get together and battle is snow.
Snow.
Yeah, because I hate it.
Yeah, yeah. Very cold.
I hate cold. I hate snow. I hate winter.
Well, you know what we could do, Larry? We could move.
I'd love to move. We should go live with the Ed.
Yeah, in Vegas.
I would do that.
Me, you, the Ed, the baby, Franklin would be great.
And those three ugly girls at Little Darlings?
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to go.
Take a run at those, yeah, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so Jesse Ventura, the conspiracy show, it's Wednesday nights at 10 o'clock, True TV. And like I said, next week, global warming. And I think they're going to be doing, I think they'll do New World Order. I saw the rundown of the shows they're going to be doing. I think 2012, they're going to have a show about that. Big Brother.
Skull and Crossbone Society, Columbine.
They're doing Columbine.
Well, I'm just saying, they're stealing all your material, Mike, though.
Oh, okay, yeah. Well, they are doing secret. Yeah, I don't think they're doing Columbine, but they're doing secret societies. So.
Oh, of course. Why not?
Yeah. But that, those are
Kurt Cobain.
No, they're not doing Kurt Cobain either. But they should. That'd be great. But,
all right. Well, what do you have on the docket tonight?
Well, this week in December, there were two important dates for conspiracy theorists in this week. The
December
first
25th.
No. Although there was plenty of conspiracies about, you know, Jesus. But
yeah, exactly.
December 7th, 1941, uh-huh. Larry, it's a day which will live in infamy.
That is true.
Pearl Harbor.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I figured, hey, let's talk about some Pearl Harbor.
Oh, let's do it, because I don't know anything.
Yeah, I like to be timely with the conspiracies, you know?
Yeah, you're doing a good job.
Yeah. Let me just check here on my notes. My computer went down. All right, Pearl Harbor, December 7, 1941. Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, on the island of Oahu.
Oahu?
And, Pearl Harbor is west of Honolulu. Now, what do you know about Pearl Harbor, Larry?
It got bombed by the Japanese.
That's right, in a surprise attack. And
yeah.
It's so famous that it was a surprise attack. It was at dawn. This was before the countries declared war. The U.S. wasn't involved in World War II yet. The Japanese just, growing up, you always hear, holy surprise, they got us at dawn, and they stabbed us in the back, even so much so, Larry, that in wrestling, what did they always call it when we were watching it as kids, when someone jumped in the ring and surprised somebody?
Pearl Harbored.
They Pearl Harbored them. You know?
Yeah.
It became part of our vernacular. Yeah, so a surprise attack at dawn on December 7th, and the U.S., the poor U.S. military was just, you know, victimized and surprised, just decimated by the Japanese squadron, the fleet, in the kamikazes, where they're just, you know, flying their planes into ships and blowing up everything. And 2,345 military personnel were killed that day. 57 civilians were killed. 1,247 military were wounded. 35 civilians were wounded. They sank four battleships, two destroyers. More battleships were damaged. Another destroyer was damaged. Three cruisers were damaged. 188 aircraft were destroyed. 155 more were damaged. So it was a devastating attack by the Japanese. And the Japanese suffered very few casualties in the whole thing. So it kind of just it was a devastating blow to the Pacific Fleet of the United States Navy. And what did it do, Larry, the Pearl Harbor?
It prompted the U.S. to get into the war.
That's right. Because up until that time, the U.S. people wanted no part of what they called Europe's war. Because Germany and Hitler, they were going around and they invaded Poland there, and they were trying to take over Europe and then whatnot. And people were like, hey, Hitler, we should do something about that. FDR wanted Franklin Delano Roosevelt there, the president. He wanted to get in there and fight the Hitler. But the U.S. people wanted no part of it because they said, hey, that's Europe's war. We don't want it. That they wanted an isolationist policy because they were still, World War I was still fresh in their minds. We're not going to do that again. So let Europe handle Europe's business. We'll stay over here, across the Atlantic, no problem. But FDR knew that Hitler was a big threat, and he didn't want Hitler taking over Europe and then you know, coming to the U.S. Now, why did Hitler, or why did FDR know that Hitler was a threat? Well, that's a whole other conspiracy we can talk about, because basically U.S. Wall Street and the bankers, they put Hitler into power. So, you know, this is all orchestrated that they wanted war, because there's a lot of money in war. War is a racket, Larry. It's a racket. And there's a great book, General Smedley Butler wrote a book, War is a Racket, and everyone should go look that up. But that's how they make the money with the war. So they were trying to get the U.S. into war with Germany, but Hitler wanted no part of the U.S. because he knew he, you know, that's a big foe. He just wanted to focus on Europe at the time being. So Roosevelt couldn't prompt Germany into starting the war, and he knew the U.S. Gallup polls back then were saying like 80% or more of the U.S. population was completely opposed to the war. They wanted no part of it. So FDR was trying to prompt Germany into firing first, you know, the first strike there, and to get the people into war, but Germany wouldn't bite. They weren't going to go after the U.S. FDR was even putting U.S. ships, you know, off the coast there and having German submarines sink them, and the U.S. people still didn't care. They're like, yeah, don't worry about it. We don't want to get in that war. It's no big deal. So he needed something, Larry. He needed something. And this is where the conspiracy comes in. The conspiracy is that FDR and the U.S. military knew about Pearl Harbor, and they allowed it to happen in order to fire up the U.S. Population and to get the motivation to enter World War II.
See, that sounds a little bit like 9/11.
Well, the key difference is that 9/11 was an act perpetrated on the American people by the American people. This was something that was allowed to happen.
Okay.
It wasn't orchestrated by FDR. It was just allowed to happen. Like,
yeah, he knew it was coming.
Yeah. Now, the key here is on September 27, 1940, Japan signs the Axis Pact with Germany and Italy, forming the Axis powers. And it was a mutual defense policy. So once that happened, like, basically it said, you know, if you attack one of us, you attack all of us. And, like, Germany agreed to defend Japan, Japan, Germany, and so forth. So once that happened on September 27, 1940, that was the opening FDR and the U.S. needed. You understand?
Uh-huh.
They're like, we can't get Germany, but we could probably trick Japan into fighting us. And so what they did was they set out to try and do everything they could to prompt Japan into attacking. And now, it was always speculated what, like, they were doing this to try and fire up Japan. But it wasn't until 1994 when a document was declassified called the McCollum Memo that people say, hey, right there, there's your smoking gun, right there. Now, what this is on October 7th, 1940, just, you know, a couple days after the Axis Pacts were signed, Lieutenant Commander Arthur McCollum of the Office of Naval Intelligence Far East Section, he was like the commanding officer for the Far East Section, he sent a memo to Navy Captains Walter Anderson and Dudley Knox. And these guys were Roosevelt's, like, two trusted military advisors. And remember the Office of Navy Intelligence, because you don't hear them a lot, but they're very key intelligence gathering operation for the U.S., and they play a pivotal role in 9/11 that no one talks about. So remember the Navy of the Office of Navy Intelligence next week when we're talking about 9/11. But, so this Arthur McCollum, he sends a memo out to Anderson and Knox, and he puts together an 8-point plan, which he says will get Japan to strike first.
Okay.
So now the 8 points, quickly: make an arrangement with Britain for the use of British bases in the Pacific, particularly Singapore. Make an arrangement with Holland for the use of battle facilities and acquisition of supplies in the Dutch East Indies. Give all possible aid to the Chinese government of Chiang Kai-shek, because Japan and China were involved in a war at the time, and Japan had entered into China. It's all very complicated. But four, send a division of long-range heavy cruisers to the Orient, Philippines, and Singapore. Send two divisions of submarines to the Orient. Keep the main strength of the U.S. fleet now in the Pacific in the vicinity of the Hawaiian Islands. Insist that Dutch refuse to grant Japanese demands for undue economic concessions, particularly oil, and completely embargo all U.S. trade with Japan in collaboration with similar embargo imposed by the British Empire. The key thing was denying Japan oil. They cut off all supplies of oil to Japan. And because of the Japanese problems with China at the time, Japan was basically just being choked to death without the oil, and they had to do something. So they were just goading the Japanese into attacking, you know? Do you see what I'm saying here, Larry?
Yeah, I hear you.
And another key point in those eight, and by the way, Knox and Anderson, they both signed off on this memo, the McCollum memo. They said, yeah, this is good stuff. Now, no one can trace it to FDR. No one can prove for a fact that FDR saw this memo. But they can say that his two trusted military advisors did see it and signed off on it, and they met with FDR, like, on a daily basis. So, basically, FDR knew about it. You know,
okay.
then people say, well, McCollum, he didn't have that much power. These memos are generated all the time. You know, who knows? It probably wasn't even taken seriously. Yeah, okay, you can believe that if you want. But the 8 points that he outlined in this memo were all taken up by the U.S. government and FDR. They all did it. And it seems to be an indication that, hey, they're doing this. But one of the key things in the 8-point memo was that he wanted the Pacific Fleet stationed at Hawaii. Now, this is key because Admiral James Otto Richardson, he refused to station a fleet at Pearl Harbor. When FDR told him, you know, we got to keep the Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor, he says, that's craziness. It's vulnerable to attack there from the Japanese. You can't just leave it there in Pearl Harbor. Because also the geographic, not only the location, but the properties of Pearl Harbor, there's a mountain range kind of by it, and you can't really see it. It leaves itself open to attack, and it's not a good place to have the fleet. This Richardson, Admiral Richardson, knew it, and he refused to keep him there. And FDR says, no, keep him there in Pearl Harbor. Richardson went back to him a second time and said, I'm not going to do it. So Roosevelt relieved Richardson of duty. And he wanted to bring in Chester W. Nimitz. Now, I don't know if you've heard of him, Larry, but he was a big World War II guy, Admiral Nimitz. He eventually became the Pacific Fleet commander, but he turned down the gig at Pearl Harbor. Now, you're probably wondering, why would he do that, right?
Yeah.
Because Nimitz knew that something was cooking there in Pearl Harbor, and he told everybody, I don't want that. I don't want to be the scapegoat for what happens in Pearl Harbor, because whoever's in command there when this goes down is going to be, you know, just destroyed, you know?
Yeah, blamed. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, they're going to be the guy who's called, you know, the traitor and not doing his job, but they're being set up. Nimitz knew this, so he turned down the command, but the guy who accepted it was Admiral Husband Kimmel, so he became the Navy commander at Pearl Harbor. Not the best decision you ever want to make, the Admiral. and the Army commander at Pearl Harbor was the General Walter Short. Now, after Pearl Harbor, 10 days after Pearl Harbor, they were both demoted and relieved of duty. And later, a commission led by Supreme Court Justice Owen J. Roberts found the duo guilty of dereliction of duty. They were basically considered traitors by all the U.S. and citizens, and they were just, you know, berated constantly for, you know, letting this happen. The Army guy Short, he left in 1942, worked for the Ford Motor Company. He died of chronic heart problems in 1949. Kimmel became employed by the Frederick Harris, Inc., doing secret work for the Navy until his death in 1968. But the servicemen at the time, they still liked Kimmel and Army. They knew something was up, that they got hung out to dry. And on May 25th, 1999, the U.S. Senate voted 52-47 to pass a non-binding resolution exonerating Kimmel and Short, admitting that they weren't given all the information they needed to defend Pearl Harbor. But no president has reinstated them to their former military ranks, because apparently that's against procedure. But it seems kind of petty and shallow for them, because they were bumped down. They were four-star generals and they were admirals, and they got bumped down, you know. But now, what information was withheld from Kimmel and Short? Well, the Japanese were running, you know, coded messages all this time. And what the Japanese didn't know was that the U.S. had broken their codes, the Purple Code, which was a real intricate coding system that was used for diplomatic messages, and then something that the U.S. called JN-25, which was all naval transmissions, like from the Japanese fleet. That's the code they used with the Navy. And now, some people dispute whether or not the JN code was broken before Pearl Harbor, but the NSA even admits that it was broken, but they try to say that they switched it a couple days before Pearl Harbor, and then the code breakers had to start all over, and they didn't have time. But obviously, if Pearl Harbor was planned by the Japanese, they didn't throw it together in one day, you know? So no. Even the NSA admits that the code was broken up until, like, December 4th. Or fifth or so. So it's like, calm down. They knew what was going on. It wasn't a secret. They knew. And the U.S. had 25 code monitoring bases all throughout the Pacific. They had 200 cryptographers working 24 hours a day. They decoded over 1,000 messages a day. And these stations also had radio direction finders. So anytime a message was sent, they could pinpoint where it was coming from. So they knew where the fleet was. And Roosevelt had his guys brief him every day about the JN-25 messages, and he'd have them read them the messages in English, like, you know, once they're translated. And so he knew what was going on every day. He was briefed on this stuff, so it wasn't a surprise. But to this day, the government still refuses to release all JN-25 transmissions due to national security.
Oh, that's always their excuse.
Yeah, after Pearl Harbor, they have no problem releasing, you know, those, but before December 7th, they will not release those transmissions because national security. Now, what do you think that national security concern is? Yeah, because, you know, it'll reveal that they knew what was going on, and
yeah,
that, you know. That's how you know something's always wrong. Like, after the JFK assassination, they steal the evidence, and they wouldn't release it for 50 years or 40 years or whatever they said at first. But why? You know, why does that stuff have to be sealed, you know? It's just silliness. So that's the basic Pearl Harbor conspiracy, that the U.S. knew what was going on, they allowed it to happen, and it fired up everybody again in World War II. And then right after Pearl Harbor, I should mention also, on December 8th in the Philippines, Douglas MacArthur was stationed in the Philippines there, and he had quite a squadron of B-17s there. And he was apparently, at Clark Air Field Base there, he was apparently told to stand down and let the Japanese attack his B-17s. And a lot of them got destroyed. And everyone throughout history is like, hey, what was MacArthur doing that day? You know, he was told to stand down because they wanted the Germans to believe that the U.S. took a terrible beating, not only at Pearl Harbor, but also in the Philippines, because they wanted to look weak, because they wanted to entice Hitler to declare war, thinking that the U.S. is vulnerable. And 4 days later, on December 11th, Germany did declare war on the United States, and then that opened up the door for the U.S. into Europe, which is where they wanted to go, to fight Hitler. So that's the World War II stuff. But yeah, a lot of people don't know about the MacArthur thing either, and so looking at that as well, if you want. But
wow.
So that's the basic Pearl Harbor conspiracy, Larry. Any questions about any of that?
Well, what do you think the bigger tragedy is, the bombing at Pearl Harbor or the bomb that was Pearl Harbor, starring Ben Affleck?
Yeah. Well, at least that had Kate Beckinsale, right?
Oh, it did.
So
it
there you go.
Did.
So
yeah.
The original one.
Yeah. Yeah, you're probably right. Kate Beckinsale, she makes up for some things.
Yeah.
Yeah, this government's, they're all liars. They're all crooked.
Yeah.
They're all...
There are some good people in the government, and not everyone in the government knows what's going on. It's just a handful of people who pull the strings and make all this stuff happen.
It always seems to be the handful that controls the majority of all the power, though.
Yeah.
Like,
who
is your candidate that you were all gung-ho for during the election last year?
The Ron Paul.
Yeah, Ron Paul. You don't think Ron Paul would ever be up to the sneakiness?
And Ron Paul will never get elected anywhere either. That's the problem.
Well, yeah.
They don't let Ron Paul into the Council on Foreign Relations, He's marginalized in Congress because, anyone who speaks the truth gets pushed aside, No one wants the truth, yeah.
He'll never be a Bilderberg?
No, not the Ron Paul. But, it's tough. It's tough, but... Just remember, America is not a country, it's not a democracy, it's a corporation. That's what you got to wrap your head around. It's a corporation. Democrat and Republican, it's all just a puppet show. It's all shenanigans. It's all meaningless. It's just a puppet show to distract you and keep you fighting against one another so you don't realize that they're just robbing you blind with the Federal Reserve every day of your life. And that's what politics is. It's just distraction. And just remember, do you think the NFL cares if the AFC or the NFC wins the Super Bowl? No, because the NFL profits either way. And that's So do you think they really care if there's a Republican or a Democrat in Congress? No. The guys profit either way. Now, it's just some guys are easier to control than others, and that's why they reach the top of the political ladder. That's why you have a guy like Obama, is it an empty suit in the White House, or an idiot like a Bush in the White House. You don't have a true leader or anyone, because they'll never get that high up,
Yeah.
The way it is. So, and even FDR, who's usually revered by everyone throughout history, he's got plenty of skeletons in his closet, dealings and stuff. But, it's just really hard to understand. But people think the Nazis were defeated in World War II, but no, the Nazis are in this country now. There's Nazis working in our government. Operation Paperclip, read up on that. They brought over the Nazis to join the government, and that you see it in the CIA, you see it in NASA, you see it everywhere. So, it sounds crazy, but it's there. Read up on it.
Do you think there's ever been a good president?
I would have.
Do you think JFK was a good guy?
Kennedy was he had his flaws, and obviously his family got their money through bootlegging, and he was. He had no real moral compass when it came to the ladies, and his wife.
Sure.
Apparently, inauguration night, two broads for Kennedy. Let me tell you.
At the same time?
Yeah. Inauguration night.
Huh.
Yep. And every time he went on the road, the Secret Service would get him a broad.
Ooh.
In his room. Yeah, every night. He was a tomcat. But, Kennedy, at least he was a good guy as far as standing up to corruption and power within government. He went head-to-head with the CIA. Over everything, he was in office thankfully when the Cuban Missile Crisis happened, because that could have been end of the world stuff right there. But so he was a good guy in terms of that, and standing up to the bankers and the corruption, and that's why he had to get rubbed out, and that's why his brother had to get rubbed out, because he would have followed in the same path. But who doesn't get rubbed out? Nixon, because he's a guy, because he's with them. He's with them. Bush, it goes from Nixon. And then the Bushes are right there. They are a continuation of Nixon. And that ties into our second conspiracy theory. So is there anything left on Pearl Harbor that that I didn't make clear?
No, I think you were pretty concise.
Yeah, it was pretty quick. But I think obviously it's a a very deep subject, and people will debate all the time whether they had, like I said, whether they broke the codes or not. But yeah, we can pretty much say they did. And a good book on the subject is Day of Deceit by Robert Stinnett, S-T-I-N-N-E-T-T. And there's tons of information out there about Pearl Harbor. Just, I mean, if you just Google Pearl Harbor, I think the conspiracy stuff comes up first, pretty much, for the officials. because by now, everyone pretty much, it's the secret that they don't want to admit it. They don't want to say, well, FDR knew, because you can't trace anything back directly to FDR. It's not like his signature's on anything, like, hey, by the way, Japan's attacking. But it's just, come on, you know, let's go. You know.
Use some common sense, yeah.
Yes, that's the thing that no one wants to ever use. It's just common sense and practicality. Figure it out. You know, it's not that hard to figure out. All right. So now this next one. Now, the reason we played at the top of the show, do you remember what music we played, Larry?
Green Day.
No. It wasn't Green Day. It was John Lennon.
Was that Lennon?
Yeah,
oh,
John Lennon.
Okay.
Working Class Hero, which is just a tremendous song, by the way. Yeah, if you want to hear just how the world works and who's in power and how they manipulate the people, just listen to that song. He pegs it. He nails it. Working Class Hero. Yeah.
Well, we talked the other day. You said, "Oh, I'm working on John Lennon conspiracy," and I got defensive for a minute there. I was like, "What are you talking about? You know, don't be, you know, I'm not going on the air if you're going to trash John Lennon." You're like, "No, it's nothing like that."
You know, John Lennon was he was the real deal. Okay, he was legit. You know,
because you know, I'm a big Beatles fan, and I really like John Lennon, and I wasn't going to stand for any John Lennon trashing.
No, John. I've never been a big Beatles fan or John Lennon guy, but I am now after doing this.
Oh,
research.
Nice.
Yeah, he's a real deal there. But there are a lot of bizarre stories about the Beatles. Conspiracies go, like, there's that one where they say Paul died and was replaced.
The Abbey Road.
Yeah, and some people are like, no, I've done enough research in the conspiracy and stuff that I realize even the most absurd stuff, as crazy as it sounds, if you look into it, you'll find something that, like, a kernel of truth there somewhere. But I think that Paul stuff, from what I read, is just rumors that started and spiraled out of control, basically.
Yeah, I mean, that's fun conspiracy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fun stuff, you know, with, Paul's dead at the end of A Day in the Light, or is it Strawberry Fields? Yeah, Strawberry Fields, where you're supposed to say, I buried Paul at the very end of the song. You're supposed to be able to hear that and that sort of stuff. But that's fun. That's fun for fans.
Yeah.
You know, everybody knew that they didn't replace Paul with an identical twin. I mean, you know, you got to be realistic at times. But I'm interested to hear what's going on with Lennon. I want to know what you dug up.
Well, he was killed December 8th, 1980. So the anniversary just passed. Now, what do you know about his death, Larry?
He was killed in New York City?
That's right, outside the Dakota, which is a hotel on 72nd Street in Central Park West in New York City.
Right. And him and Yoko were coming home from something. I don't know where they were. Probably
they're at the recording
some sort of
studio.
Art show. Oh, okay.
They're at a recording studio working on a song. I believe the song, the track was Out on Thin Ice, or You're on Thin Ice, something like that.
Okay.
And they had recorded that, and they were returning home. And
and apparently an overzealous Beatle fan named Mark David Chapman shot him.
That's right, an overzealous Beatle fan, they always say. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mark David Chapman.
That's all I really know. I always just took it at face value.
That's right. That's what everyone only knows. Now, this is one of those ones where the reason why this is a great conspiracy theory is because it's one of those stories that, once again, like Columbine, where you just take on face value and it just becomes part of the culture and you grow up with it. You never even think to question it. And you think, well, even when you start to question it, you're like, well, that's kind of iffy. But then the deeper you get into it, you're like, oh, my God.
Yeah, I want to know.
This is one of my favorites already, just because it's so interesting. But let me just go down the official story real quick. Like we said, outside the Dakota, and the Dakota was kind of a fancy hotel, and it's got like a big archway entrance that you walk under, and then like there's an empty courtyard and there's four buildings around the courtyard, and then one of them is Lennon's hotel there. But so there's a big archway you walk under, and there's a doorman stationed outside the archway in a little gold like booth. So keep all that in mind. But earlier in the day, when Lennon and Yoko were leaving for their recording studio, Mark David Chapman and a bunch of other fans were outside waiting to get autographs. I think it was around 5 o'clock when this happened. And John Lennon actually signed an album, the Double Fantasy album, for Mark David Chapman. I don't know. There's a famous picture. It's very creepy, of Lennon signing the album and Mark David Chapman are over his shoulder. They're smiling at him. And just
really?
Hours later, yeah, oh, it's very creepy. Yeah, and then hours later, Chapman kills him, supposedly. So, yeah, that's just bizarre that there's a photo of it. But yeah, so he signs the autograph for Mark David Chapman, and Lennon actually says to him, "Is there anything else you want?" I believe he says, "Or is there anything else you want of me?" or something like that. And Chapman just is nervous, and he says, "No, no, no." So you know, John leaves. Now Yoko later says that Lennon told her that that Chapman creeped him out, like he was a little
really.
Nervous. Yeah, he said that he was a little nervous by that dude. Kind of was weird, and so you know that's just Yoko saying that. So they go into the studio and they record and they come back. They return by limo at approximately 10:50 p.m. and Chapman is still there, waiting outside the Dakota Archway entrance. Now it's been about 5 hours, and actually he's waiting inside the archway, which is supposed to be off limits, you know, and that's why there's a doorman there. The doorman is supposed to keep people from going through the archway. But for some reason, this doorman befriended Mark David Chapman, apparently, during the 5 hours that they were waiting there. And at the time, Mark David Chapman was the only fan waiting there. No one else was there. And, well, maybe we'll get into the other stuff later. But so Chapman's there inside the archway. Yoko leaves the limo first, and she's about 35 feet ahead of John. And so she's already walking into the hotel when Lennon passes Chapman. And Chapman walks by and just nods, but they don't exchange words. Now, there's some dispute whether once Lennon passes, whether Chapman says, "Excuse me, Mr. Lennon," or if, but most people don't think he said anything, because there's very few witnesses to this whole thing. That's another reason it's tough to pinpoint a lot of this. But so Lennon walks past him. Chapman pulls out a .38 revolver and fires 5 shots into Lennon. Lennon is hit twice in the upper left shoulder, like the back portion of the shoulder, kind of. Then twice in the left side of the shoulder, and then one bullet misses him, and goes into breaks the glass door of the hotel there. And there's some dispute whether it was actually the door or like during the winter they set up a little entranceway. It may have been that door. There's some dispute about that. But so 5 shots were fired, and the bullets that struck him in the upper left back, apparently they cut the aorta, I believe, and the heart and stuff, and so he eventually died. But Lennon stayed up and staggered into the hotel through the archway, into the hotel, and collapses at the concierge desk. And Yoko's there, and she cradles him, and she says, "John's been shot," and then the help comes. But Mark David Chapman, an assassin. What do you think he did, Larry? You think he probably ran, right? No, he didn't run. No.
What did he do?
Well, he shoots Lennon, and he didn't leave the scene. And there's a subway entrance, like only like 60 feet away, so he could have easily just ran to the subway and split. But he just stood there at the scene, and apparently the doorman walks up to him and goes, "Do you know what you just did?" And he says, "I killed John Lennon." And he dropped the gun, and he pulls from his pocket a copy of the book, The Catcher in the Rye, by J.D. Salinger. And he stays at the scene, and he calmly reads from Catcher in the Rye until the police show up.
All right.
That's a little peculiar, right?
Well, that's real weird, yeah.
Yeah. So apparently the doorman kicks the gun, according to his story, he kicks the gun away, and he just sits there until the police comes. So that's bizarre.
Well, yeah, that's not typically what you see in an assassin.
No, not really.
Nobody hangs out. Nobody wants to be caught after they killed somebody.
Yeah, so, let's look into Mark David Chapman a little closer, maybe. You know?
Okay.
He was born in 1955 in Fort Worth, Texas. By all accounts, he had kind of a messed up childhood, came from a conservative military family. In his teenage years, he experimented with LSD, and he became a bit of like what they called a Jesus freak, really religious. Mm. Now, he worked for the YMCA. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but the YMCA is apparently a CIA front.
The YMCA?
Yes. According to Philip Agee, a former CIA, he was involved in the Kennedy stuff too, Philip Agee. But he's a former CIA operative. He says that the government goes through the YMCA to do a bunch of stuff, shady stuff. So take that for what it's worth. But so he worked for the YMCA. But just his life, his background, he was a prime target for for what would be mind programming. You know, we talked about before MK Ultra and stuff like that when we were talking about Sirhan Sirhan and Robert Gay.
Yeah.
So in 1975, David Chapman, when he's 20 years old, he volunteers for a YMCA trip. Now, where do you think the YMCA, what would it be a usual YMCA trip? I don't know, like, you know, California or something. I don't know. Maybe Europe. No, he goes to Beirut. Beirut,
huh.
Lebanon. Yeah, 1975. This is just when the Civil War is breaking out there in Beirut. Now, that's unusual. And it just so happens that during this time, the CIA ran assassination camps in Beirut. And this was the center of George Habash, H-A-B-A-S-H. He ran CIA assassination teams in Beirut. And this was identified in the House Select Committee on Assassinations in 1977-78. This is a matter of documented, you know, government. They admit it. You know, he's running assassination teams in Beirut. So it just so happens that Mark David Chapman is in Beirut during this time, which peculiar, all right? So after 6 months in Lebanon, Chapman returns stateside and works for World Vision, which is another CIA front. There, it's a Christian relief organization started in 1950, and on the board of World Vision was none other than John Hinckley Sr. Where do you know that name, Larry John Hinckley, though?
Reagan?
That's right.
Ronald Reagan?
I'm enjoying a beverage, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's fine.
But,
yeah,
so World Vision. World Vision. We need to do a whole other conspiracy show on just World Vision.
That's not like anything, it doesn't, like, it's nothing to do with, like, a lens crafters or anything like that.
No. It's a Christian relief organization. And basically, you can adopt kids and stuff through World Vision, and they go to third world countries, and they're like, hey, we help out these third world countries. Well, that's cute and all, but actually it's a CIA front, and they use it to recruit mercenaries in those third world countries. They use it in Honduras, Nicaragua, and El Salvador to perpetrate revolutions in those countries. And Bush Sr. in particular was pivotal in all this stuff, and like the El Salvador killing fields and whatnot. They get these squads together, and they just go through and killing people. And but that's the CIA at its finest, and they work through World Vision. And so when Chapman came back stateside, he got a job at World Vision, working at a Vietnamese refugee camp at Fort Chaffee, Arkansas, which is also a CIA headquarters. So that's, again, unusual, you know?
Yeah, a lot of CIA indirectly tied,
yes.
You know, he's tied to the CIA a lot of ways indirectly.
And these World Vision refugee camps, they came under fire because they would, the methods they used with a lot of the refugees was rather forceful and, you could say torture, maybe. A lot of it. And Mark David Chapman was there. Right? So Beirut, and then working with Vietnamese refugees, which is odd. All right, so Chapman settled in Hawaii in 1976. Now, that may not sound so bad. Hey, Hawaii.
Pearl Harbor.
Nice place to live. Yeah, Pearl Harbor. But also, Hawaii was also big in CIA operations, especially mind control after Vietnam. Like, a lot of read up on Hawaii's history and the CIA. They did a lot of stuff in Hawaii for some reason. And once again, Mark David Chapman just happens to be in Hawaii. And where's he getting all this money to travel all over the place? You know, that's another thing we got to worry about. But then in 1980, he took a trip around the world. Because a lot of shiftless loner drifters often just take trips around the world, don't they?
Yeah, Jack Dawson on the Titanic.
Yeah, and like Lee Harvey Oswald. Remember him? He would just go to for a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And go to Cuba.
Yeah.
That's odd. No. He's just a loner. He's a drifter, yeah. Where do they get the money to do this, you know? I don't know. But he left Hawaii for Atlanta in October of 1980, and he was in Atlanta, Georgia a little bit, and then he took a trip to New York. Now, he was supposedly going to kill John Lennon during this trip in October, but he lost his nerve and returned to Hawaii. Once again, where is he getting this money? You know, trips to Hawaii aren't cheap, especially back in 1980. And he's going back and forth, and he really... They said he worked at a hospital. He's a hospital worker. But no, he never held a job. And he was married. I don't know how that happened. But he was married to a lady who worked at a travel agency in Hawaii. And but then there's suspicious connections for the travel agency as well we could look into. But they lived in an apartment that was $400 a month. They had no money. Yet, oddly enough, he had an expensive habit of collecting fine art. And he owned a Norman Rockwell first print worth $7,500, and he had a couple other famous paintings, which is odd. Yet he supposedly had no money and no means of support. And now he went back to New York on December 5th and killed Lennon 3 days later on December 8th. But no one can really, but there's some questions about where he was during that time. We'll get into that. Chapman also, when he was in New York, stayed in very expensive hotels. And when he was arrested there at the scene, he had $2,000 in cash on him, plus credit cards.
Wow.
Which is, again, you know, hard to do when you apparently don't have a job.
Yeah, because I have a job, and I don't have $2,000 in cash or credit cards.
Yeah, and keep in mind, this is 1980, $2,000 in cash, so that was much more money.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the Ed walks around with $2,000 on him. But
yeah, well, he's a high roller, though.
You know? Yeah. Detective Arthur O'Connor, who was one of the main guys after Chapman was arrested, he spent a lot of time with Chapman while he's trying to wait for trial and stuff. And he says, quote, "It is definitely illogical to say that Mark committed the murder to make himself famous, because that's always the excuse people say, that he did it to get fame and to steal John Lennon's fame and stuff. He did not want to talk to the press from the very start. It's possible Mark could have been used by somebody. I saw him the night of the murder. I studied him intensely. He looked as if he could have been programmed."
Uh-oh.
Yeah, here we go. We're getting somewhere now. Let's see, the airplane ticket. We got to talk about Chapman's airplane ticket. Chapman had actually purchased his ticket in Hawaii. It was supposed to go to Chicago. It was United Airlines, and it was going to depart December 2nd, 1980, with no connecting flights. The return date was December 18th. After the killing, the police went to his hotel room, and I didn't write down the name of the hotel, but it was a fancy hotel. It wasn't some dive hotel. And the ticket they found in the hotel room was for December 5th arrival and December 18th return. See, the original ticket he bought in Hawaii, he was supposed to, I may have said depart, but so it's a departing December 5th and December 18th return. So the return dates were the same, but the departing dates were different, or the arrival dates. I may have missed that up. But the original ticket he bought was for December 2nd. The ticket they found in his hotel room was for December 5th. See what's going on there? The ticket is different. Yet the serial number on the ticket was identical. Now, they asked the Houston police to check in on that. Captain Louis L. Sousa of the Honolulu Police verified the original ticket date. And the people who knew Chapman in Hawaii said that he did leave on December 2nd there. He didn't leave December 5th or whenever he was supposed to arrive in New York. So the original ticket he bought in Hawaii was the ticket that he had when he left, you know. So how did he get a different ticket with a different date in his hotel room? And where was he from December 2nd to December 5th? Those 3 days are key, because it would almost seem like the government changed the ticket, or whoever. I'm sorry, maybe I'm jumping the gun on the government. But to hide the fact that there's a 3-day missing time there, you know? Like the ticket was changed.
Okay.
See what's going on here?
Yeah.
All right. So why the change in the airplane ticket, and where was he between December 2nd and December 5th? Those are key questions that have never really been answered. Now, the catcher in the rye. Why the obsession with the catcher in the rye? Because every media story after the killing said that he was, first, he was an obsessed Beatles fan, and that he was also obsessed with the book Catcher in the Rye and Holden Caulfield. Catcher in the Rye has always been rumored to be involved in MKUltra, government mind programming stuff. And oddly enough, he purchased a copy of Catcher in the Rye on his first trip to New York when he was supposedly going to kill John Lennon. And when he returned to Hawaii, he threw it away. And when he went to New York again, first thing he did, he bought another copy of Catcher in the Rye, which is peculiar. And apparently he would say to himself, "The catcher in the rye says John Lennon must die." Yeah, that was a little catchphrase he said. And he would hear voices. At the time of the killing, he says he heard voices, "Do it, do it, do it," in his head. And he would keep telling himself, "The phony must die, the phony must die." And later on, when he was on trial, he originally pleaded not guilty by reason of insanity. But then in the middle of the trial, he changed his plea to guilty. And when his attorney was very upset by this, and he says, "Mark, why are you changing your plea to guilty?" He says, "I heard a small man's voice in my head telling me to change my plea to guilty." So is that insanity, or is it something else? You know, programming. But also Sirhan Sirhan, his diaries always had RFK must die, RFK must die, written in them over and over again. And then you have Mark David Chapman with the phony must die, over and over again. Catcher in the Rye, John Lennon must die. It's very bizarre, you know. Just something to keep in mind. Now, getting back to the doorway, or the doorman, I should say, at the hotel. Remember I said there's a doorman, Larry, and he kicked the...
Yeah, a little old booth.
Yeah, well, right after, all the newspaper reports... in the days that, and I should mention that the only way you can research this basically is going through newspaper reports, because the police didn't do an investigation at all. Because when they showed up, they had Mark David Chapman there saying he did it, and the doorman was a witness saying, yeah, he killed John Lennon. Because when the police first got there, they didn't believe that Chapman did it. They said, this guy couldn't have killed anybody. He, you know, he doesn't, he's not acting like a killer. And the doorman said, no, he killed John Lennon. And then Chapman says, yes, I killed John Lennon or whatever. But the police weren't buying it. But they said, all right, well, he's confessed. And obviously there's nothing to go against him. We got a witness. So, all right, they didn't even conduct an investigation. The police reports are very scarce with details. So you got to go on the newspaper reports of the day. And the newspaper reports talk about the doorman being there, but they misidentify him. They call the doorman by the concierge's name, the guy who was inside the hotel when John Lennon went in and collapsed. So they confused the two in the initial newspaper reports. And the doorman's actual name wasn't revealed until 6 or 7 years later in a People magazine article. And his name just happens to be Jose Padermo, P-A-D-E-R-M-O. Now, that doesn't seem odd at first, but then you look into this Jose Padermo character. Now, he said Chapman, he seemed like a good kid, a quiet kid. In the time while Lennon was at the studio, because remember he had the autograph signed for Chapman, and then he went to the studio, and then Chapman waited there the 5 hours. That time, Padermo said he spent with Chapman talking about what? The Bay of Pigs and the Kennedy assassination. That's odd, right? But so you're like, well, you know, people like that kind of stuff. I mean, if I was spent 5 hours with somebody, I'd probably talk about the Bay of Pigs and the Kennedy assassination, too.
Yeah, you probably would.
Yeah, but here's the thing. It just so happens that in the Bay of Pigs, there was a CIA guy who was running it. Oh, it just happened to be named Jose Padermo. He was a CIA killer, and he was involved in the Bay of Pigs. And so that's a coincidence, right? You know?
Yeah.
So people start looking into this, and they're like, well, was it the same Jose Padermo? You know? Now, it's... there's some debate whether it is or not. No one can really see, because there's another CIA guy, I think Frank Sturgis, who says that Padermo died in the mid 70s, I think, around 74, 76 or something. But you know, they say that about a lot of CIA guys, that they die, but then they just change their name and go somewhere else. Because he also worked under a different name with the CIA. So who knows? But it's certainly a coincidence that a guy named Jose Padermo was involved with the CIA in the Bay of Pigs. And then there's a doorman named Jose Padermo, who's working at this hotel at the same time, talking to Mark David Chapman about the Bay of Pigs.
Yeah, that's very odd.
Certainly a coincidence at worst. But this is the part where I don't understand why this can't be verified. Because, like I said, I just started looking into this. But and there's not a lot of evidence or eyewitnesses to the killing. That's pretty much it, just the doorman and Mark David Chapman. Because, like I said, Yoko was even inside the hotel when the shots fired, so she didn't even see anything. But you think someone would be able to go to that hotel, the Dakota, if you're real serious about investigating this, and say, hey, when did you hire this Jose Padermo? How long did he work here? And what were the reasons why he left? Like, that's what I... because if this guy's been working there for, you know, 30 years or something, you know, obviously it's not the same guy. And if he had this job long before John Lennon took residence in the hotel, obviously it's not the guy. But if he got this job after Lennon was there and he left shortly after this, well, then, yeah, there could be something fishy there, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't know why someone doesn't just do that. Like, why can't you?
Because
I don't know. Yeah.
Nobody, they're not going to tell you anything.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, we had it for
20
years.
At least try. All right, so the plot thickens. We're running out of time here. I got to get going. But now, Chapman's arrested. He's taken into court. Like, he's going to be not guilty, reasons of insanity or whatever. I think that's what the original plea was going to be. But the court wants, they bring in three psychiatrists, though, to testify to the fact that he's insane. So maybe they wouldn't want to get him off of the charges yet. But the three psychiatrists that testified to Chapman's insanity are Dr. Milton Klein, Dr. Bernard Diamond, and Dr. Daniel Schwartz. All three have CIA connections, oddly enough.
Okay.
Yeah, that's bizarre. Diamond was involved with Sirhan Sirhan. Klein, Milton Klein, now this guy, he's a real beauty because he's on the record as saying that you give him anybody for 3 months, and he could turn them into a patsy. 6 months, he could turn them into a Manchurian candidate killer. And that's the guy who's involved with Mark David Chapman. And Bernard Diamond, like I said, was involved in Sirhan Sirhan. So it's just bizarre, the connections, you know? And you got a doctor here saying that he can mind program someone to make him a killer. And then he's, I don't know. So anyway, the key here, though, is there was no trial because Chapman changed his plea to guilty. Now, had there been a trial, all this stuff would have come out, all these weird connections of the CIA and all that stuff, but no trial. So Mark David Chapman, because he heard that small voice in his head, he received 20 years in prison, and he's still in prison. He's been denied parole pretty much every year because they say he still might pose a threat to society or whatever. Now, Mark David Chapman, unlike Sirhan Sirhan, who says he doesn't remember anything about killing RFK and, like, it's all nothing, Chapman still says he killed Lenin. And, you know, he doesn't deny it. And he seems quite pleased that he did. Like, not pleased, but happy with himself. But here's the thing. He wasn't an overzealous Beatles fan. That's all shenanigans and made up by the media. He actually, his musical hero is actually Todd Rundgren. Do you know who that guy is, Larry?
I've heard the name.
Yeah,
I'm
he's like a 70s guy. But he didn't, Chapman didn't even own a Beatles record or a Lennon record until he bought Double Fantasy, which he got Lennon to autograph there. That's the first Beatles or Lennon's record he owned. And he never had a copy of Catcher in the Rye until he went to New York and bought it that time. So all this stuff that, you know, he's obsessed with Catcher in the Rye and the Beatles, that's not, it's simply not true. You know, it's just media lies that are perpetrated, you know, pushed out there for people to believe. He wasn't an obsessed fan. Clearly he's insane. And he has something wrong with him. But or was he programmed? You know, so it's very odd. Now, what would be the motive in killing John Lennon? That's what you're probably wondering, right, Larry?
Yeah, why?
Exactly. Now, our generation, we kind of forget that we think of him as just the Beatles guy and the lead singer and whatnot, but he was a big-time political thorn in the side for the Nixon administration in the 1960s. He was a major force in this country as far as anti-war goes and peace movements. Like we just hear little bits about it, but you really don't appreciate it until you go back and watch some of the old 60s films and videos of the power that he had. And in 1971... Lennon held a benefit concert for an activist named John Sinclair, who had been arrested 2 years previously, and because he tried to give two marijuana joints to an undercover police officer, and he was sentenced to 10 years in jail for those two marijuana joints, and which seems a little harsh, you know. So there was all kind of movements to try and get John Sinclair out of prison, and on 1971, Lennon held a concert, and 3 days after the concert, because of public pressure, the Michigan Supreme Court reversed its stance and called the marijuana laws unconstitutional and freed John Sinclair. That's a big deal, you know. And you know who else noticed was J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI. And once they saw that that was the kind of impact Lennon could have on public opinion and, laws, basically. They got a law overturned because of John Lennon. Hoover and the FBI started keeping a very intense file on John Lennon. And the CIA started watching him. And there's still documents that are classified regarding Lennon, but recently, like just not too long ago, through the Freedom of Information Act, they finally got out to release a bunch of this stuff. They had literally thousands of pages on John Lennon, the FBI watching him and stuff, and a lot of it's still redacted, all blacked out, so they won't even tell you what's going on. But they kept kept watch on him very tightly. They basically harassed him, they tapped his phone, and they were blatant about it, and they were trying to scare him. There's plenty of video and interviews of John Lennon talking about the FBI and what they were doing to him. And it's very interesting stuff. And Lennon was he was basically an enemy of the state. And on his one FBI file, it stated all extremists should be considered dangerous in big block letters. And they even say he should be neutralized some way. Now, they didn't know how to do it exactly. Did they want to kill him? I don't know. But in 1972, they tried to deport him on an old marijuana arrest back in England when he was much younger. And it was obviously a trumped-up charge, and there was no reason to deport him because of this. The reason they wanted to get him out of the country because of his political stances and the political movements he was leading. So this was a bitter fight because Lennon didn't want to be deported because Yoko, in order to keep custody of her child, she had to stay in America. So and Lennon wanted to be the family guy, so he couldn't be deported. So he was fighting the government for 4 years there about this deportation. It didn't end until 1976 when the Carter administration came in. And pressure relaxed on Lennon, and they actually ended all surveillance of him in 76 under Carter. And Lennon went and retreated into the shadows. He was pretty much not involved in politics anymore. He took time off. He was with his family. And basically he was a heroin addict during a lot of that time. But towards the end there, he got off the heroin, and he was back recording albums. He went making music, and he was in the recording studio again, like we mentioned, and he wanted to get in politics again. And he just, even the day of his killing, earlier that day, he did an interview where he said he was going to be getting back into politics hardcore because the Reagan administration, Reagan had just won election. He would be going into the White House in a couple weeks. And he knew that this meant a return of Nixon's policies in the Republican war agenda and the military complex. and the fact that the Cold War with the Russians and the big rise in the military again. So he intended to get back into the anti-war, anti-government stuff, and he was even making plans to go to California to protest against a labor union, a work stoppage thing going on there in the auto industry. So he was ready. He was coming back hardcore to get into politics and everything. And oddly enough, that's when he gets rubbed out by Mark David Chapman.
Huh.
So that's where the Lenin conspiracy is. And he was killed just weeks before Reagan took the White House, or should I say George Bush took the White House, because once again Hinckley tried to assassinate Ronald Reagan, and George Bush, Herbert Walker, was the vice president. So that was an attempted coup by Bush and his cronies in the CIA to try and take over the White House. But Reagan didn't die. And that's a fascinating story we got to talk about, the Reagan assassination. We'll get into that. But the guy who tried to shoot him was John Hinckley Jr., who was the son of John Hinckley Sr., who started World Vision, and who just happened to be best buddies with George Bush. And one of his oil partners was Hinckley. And so, once again, it's one of these coincidences that you just have to be an idiot to not think something's going on. You know, and I hate to say that, because that's what everyone says. Well, you're an idiot if you don't see it. But come on. You know, let's go. The best friend of George, one of his best buddies' son, tries to kill Reagan. What? and once again, Hinckley may have been programmed, because Hinckley worked for World Vision, the junior, the son. And he went through a lot of the same stuff Chapman did. And in his apartment, when the police went there, they found a copy of Catcher in the Rye right there on the coffee table. Now, of course, I own a copy of Catcher in the Rye, and I'm not mind programmed either. But millions of people own it. Doesn't mean anything. But at the same time, it's one of those coincidences that, hey, that's kind of odd. And just 3 weeks apart, two assassinations, one attempt, one successful, and they both have similar connections to CIA and Hinckley, World Vision. Come on, you know?
It's a little fishy, Mike Dowell. I got to be honest with you.
Yeah, it's more than a little fishy. It's downright scary. What's going on there?
No.
Yeah.
Yoko had nothing to do with this.
No, see, that's I don't think so. But who knows? Because there are some people that think Yoko was Lenin's CIA handler. Like, she was there to basically keep him under control. But I don't buy that. I don't know. Who knows? I think Yoko, because when you watch her now talking about John, I don't think she would. I don't think she had anything to do with it. But who knows? But, yeah, just know that John Lennon's death, there's much, much more to it than you probably think or willing to believe. You know? Just the connections to World Vision and the Beirut, the Vietnamese refugees. Come on, you know, Mark David Chapman. You don't just travel around the world like that and doing all this crazy stuff, you know? That's a government asset that they're doing that with. They're training them. They're getting them ready. And he served his purpose, you know?
Now you said he got 20 years.
20 years.
Okay, but this has been like 30 years now.
Yeah, every year he's been denied parole to get out because they say yeah, go ahead.
But once you serve your time, don't you serve your time no matter what? Really?
Not if you still pose a threat to society, because that's what they always say. Oh, we're still not sure you're done, you know? So, you know.
Oh, that would suck.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's still...
Yeah.
Watch.
That was good stuff, Mike, though.
Yeah, John
Pearl
Lennon.
Harbor, John Lennon.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. We're out of show.
Yeah. It flew by. Yeah. That's why we got to just do LCS conspiracies, forget the hockey. And what did you say LCS stands for?
Lies, conspiracies, and subterfuge.
Yeah, maybe we'll do that. And like on the website, instead of pictures of the Penguins and the Stanley Cup, we'll have pictures of a Nikola Tesla. That'd be a great one, and Kennedy and Oswald and like Lennon, and it'll be great, you know.
All right, Jack Ruby.
Yeah, Jack Ruby, a guy who was a willing patsy. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, David Ferry. All right. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, forget the hockey talk.
Yeah, I'm done. You know, I'm done with the hockey. I think. Well, last year's hockey season was so beautiful and perfect that I'm just done with it, you know?
I watched the Penguins. That's it. I could care less.
Yeah.
Speaking of Pittsburgh, though, the Steelers are down to the Browns 13-6 with about 2.5 minutes to go.
Okay.
It's a sad, sad, it's a sad, sad game, Mark, though.
And that's hard to believe. And good for me, though, we're playing our buddy Craig Dodge in the ESPN Fantasy League, and Centennial Holmes is worth 12 points. Big Ben only 8, so that's working out.
Ooh, yeah. Yeah, I benched Big Ben all over the place. So.
All right, Larry.
All right.
We're plumb out of show. Got to thank Cousin Brandon, cousinbrandon.wordpress.com, and Twitter.com facebook.com/, I don't know, Cousin Brandon, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, Twitter.
Something,
I don't know.
Something close.
Twitter's for the, yeah. And then we've got, I think, Security Guy Irv. That was great, right?
SGI, yeah, I love SGI. You know, still, once again, the Larry the Cable Guy thing.
A little bit,
you know, maybe, yeah, I might like him a little less now, but either way.
Got to thank the Ed.
The Ed, he called in 17 times today, so thanks to him.
Delivering pizzas.
And, yeah. And thanks to Mike Dell for the good conspiracy talk.
Yeah,
it seems to be,
yeah,
the segment that everybody loves. Yeah.
All the kids at the orphanage tell me, more conspiracies, Uncle Mike. And I'm like, all right. And then, hey, next week, 9/11.
Yeah, the big special, which everybody's looking forward to, 9/11. Nick suggested we waited till September to do it, and I was like,
that's a long wait.
Like,
yeah.
That's 9-10 months from now. Yeah,
yeah.
So next week. So yeah, look for that next Wednesday night, 9/11, the special edition on the LCS Hockey Radio Show. Are we gonna drop hockey from the title of the show then? We're just gonna be the LCS show?
No, because I like irony. So
yeah, we should keep the hockey in. And wine. All right. That's it. We got nothing else. We thanked everybody. Like I said, next Wednesday we'll be back to do it again. Go buy Honest John Churchfield. It's not too late. You know, your stocking stuffers. You can get that over at LCS or Lulu. Can you still buy it there?
Yeah, I think so. Larry, I forgot to mention, though, about the John Lennon.
Uh-huh.
I wanted to give people some leads they could follow up there if they want to read more about the John Lennon.
All right.
A couple good places to start. Let's see. I got to find it. There's an English lawyer named Fenton Bressler who wrote a book, Who Killed John Lennon. That'd be a good place to start. And also there's a researcher named Mae Brussel. She's passed away, but she's one of the pioneers in conspiracy and alternative news research. And she knew John Lennon, and she wrote had a couple interviews about what she thought happened, and she's very good on it. She knows a lot of stuff. And also a great documentary came out a couple years ago, I think a couple years, The U.S. versus John Lennon, a documentary. Like, if you want to realize the impact John Lennon had on society and the culture of the 60s and the 70s and why he would be a target to be eliminated, read The U.S. or watch The U.S. versus John Lennon. It's very good.
Okay. Yeah, maybe I'll do that. That sounds good. And, yeah, U.S. versus John Lennon. Check that out. Yeah, I like how you give everybody, you know, you start them down the path, and then here you go. If you want to keep going with this and check it out for yourself.
You don't have to believe it. You know, you don't have to trust me.
Yeah.
But,
you're just opening the door, Mike Dell. That's all you're doing. It's
exactly.
A learning experience. Yeah.
That's right.
You're just you're the key master. So, all right. I got nothing else. You got anything else, Mike Dell?
I got nothing. I think the Ed's calling me on the other line. So probably...
Son of a bitch. That goddamn Ed. All right. Next Wednesday, 9 o'clock. Until then, pass the gin. Come on.